It's Macy's one-day sale with great deals of the day, just in time for the holidays. Like 60 to 65% off Effie Fine Jewelry, 60 to 65% off coats the whole family will love, and get 20 to 60% off Toys R Us favorites from Barbie, Paw Patrol, Discovery, and more. Plus, everyone gets $10 in Macy's money for every $50 spent, starting tomorrow at Macy's. Savings off sale and clearance prices. Exclusions apply.
The Venture X card from Capital One gives you more of what you love, like premium travel benefits and access to Taylor Swift tickets. Ooh, I do love her. Earn 5 times miles on flights and 10 times miles on hotels through Capital One Travel.
Enjoy your stay in Suite 13.
Whoa, 13? That's Taylor's lucky number. Plus, get access to Taylor Swift The Eras Tour, presented by Capital One. Maybe I'll see you there. The Venture X card from Capital One. What's in your wallet?
Terms apply. See CapitalOne.com for details.
It's a season of giving back. That's why Kia is expanding our partnership with St. Jude Children's Research Hospital and making a donation for every eligible new car purchase during the holidays through Kia's Accelerate the Good program. Kia, movement that inspires.
Kia will donate $8 for every new Kia vehicle that is purchased or leased at authorized Kia dealerships and delivered to retail customers between November 11, 2022 and December 31, 2022, with a guaranteed minimum donation of $1 million to St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. See kia.com/seasonofgivingback for details.
This view was worth a hike.
Right? And it's a good way to stay on top of my health.
Yes. I'm Cologuard, a prescription colon cancer screening option for people 45 plus at average risk. Have you screened for colon cancer?
Not yet.
Don't wait. It's more treatable when caught in early stages.
Tell me more.
Cologuard is non-invasive and it's used at home. It detects altered DNA in your stool to find 92% of colon cancers.
92%?
Yep, even those in early stages.
This was seen in a clinical study with patients 50 and older. Any positive result should be followed by a diagnostic colonoscopy. False positive and negative results may occur. Cologuard is not a replacement for colonoscopy in high-risk patients. Do not use if you have had adenomas, have inflammatory bowel disease and certain hereditary syndromes, or a personal or family history of colon cancer.
Most insured patients pay $0. Ask your provider or an online prescriber if Cologuard is right for you, or visit Cologuard.com.
I'm in.
At the Home Depot, we have plenty of Christmas trees to make your holidays even more magical. Hundreds of full, easy-to-assemble artificial trees that look so real, you may be convinced they actually are. And for those who love that fresh pine smell, we have a parking lot full of fresh-cut trees to call your own. We'll even help you load your tree in the car so you can bring home the holidays. The Home Depot, how doers get more done.
Get ready, Ohio. FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook, is coming to the Buckeye State. And to kick things off, you can get started with $100 in free bets as an early sign-on bonus. Plus, when you sign up today with promo code Ohio, you'll be all set for when FanDuel goes live in Ohio. Then you can bet on all your favorite teams and all your favorite sports with $100 in free bets. Just download FanDuel's top-rated sportsbook app. It's safe, secure, and super easy to use. Make every moment more with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the NFL. 21 plus and present in Ohio. Bonus issued in non-withdrawable free bets that expire 7 days after FanDuel accepts its first real money sports wager in Ohio. 1-1-23. Unique user identity verification required. Offer ends on the go live date. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. Ohio, this is your chance to get in on the action. Join today with promo code Ohio.
People say I ain't no good, and I'm crazy as a loon. Cause I shave my head in the morning, pick guitar in the afternoon. Just like old Chief and Charlie, I like to lay around in the shade. Well, I ain't got no money, but you better believe I got it made. Cause I ain't asking nobody for nothing. I can't get it on my own. If you don't like the way I'm living, just leave this bald-headed country boy alone.
We're excited to bring on a couple new sponsors this month, and let me tell you about one that I am going to be using quite regularly: Alive and Well Hydration. Live and Well Hydration is a mobile IV infusion group. They can do everything from cold and flu, COVID regeneration, fat burners, more energy, B12 injections, prenatal care for all your rough days, athlete recovery, and the hangover cure. Guys, first off, I went to school with this dude who has this place now, or is part of it, Mr. Justin Frost. Thank you for being a sponsor. And let me tell you, they do weddings. They'll come to your house. They come to your office. They'll come to wherever, maybe even your podcast studio. And I just want to tell the folks over at Alive and Well Hydration, I plan on using y'all. Heck, I'm going to have to with the way that my year is going, or the way that my year is going to end anyway. So y'all do me a favor. Y'all go look up Alive and Well Hydration here in Middle Georgia now. New with us this month is C. Martin Construction. My buddy, Dennis Farmer's granddaddy, started it back when he was 16 years old, and my buddy Dennis took it over here recently. They offer everything from site prep, demolition, pond digging, grading, land clearing. My buddy Dennis is cool as hell. Y'all make sure y'all go check them out at C. Martin Construction. They have a money-back guaranteed. If you don't like their service, then they'll make it right with you. I know these folks personally, and as far as construction goes, I think you'll be in damn good hands. So give my guy a call now at 478-283-1246. Call Mr. Dennis Farmer at C. Martin Construction now. How about some cowboy stuff? My buddy, old friend, Chris Sapp, owner of Desperado and Company, over at the Pooler Tanger Outlet Mall. They are in Suite 611. They offer all kind of Western wear. Boots, toddlers, youth, women's, men's, everything. They have Ariat wallets, phone cases, men and women's jewelry, Montana silversmith, belt buckles, Ariat belts for men. They offer clinch. Ariat and Wrangler are their main brands of clothes. Lots of exotic boots. Guys, I saw some of the stuff that they're bringing me and some of the stuff I get to try on. Let me tell you, there's a lot of great Western wear places that are up in Nashville that I get to go to. This place compares to every single one of them. So what I need you guys to do is look up Desperado and Company, Chris Sapp. Their phone number is 912-604-0389. Go check them out. Get all turquoise the hell up. Get all westerned up. Look like a cowboy, cowgirl. Western fashion is the coolest shit to me, by the way. And the fact that they're on board as a sponsor now, I can't wait to try on some of the stuff that he has sent me and everything that they have sent me in pictures to get my size in. Dude, it's all banging. It's all awesome. So look up Desperado & Company now. Mr. Chris Sapp, once again, the Pooler Tanger Outlet Mall, Suite 611. Let me tell you about the wonderful Miss Vicky down at Dolly's Delights. This time of year is when every one of y'all are looking for something to give your coworkers, your friends, your family, whatever, whoever. And let me tell you, she does these wonderful gift baskets. She brought me one to the studio yesterday. She wanted to change her ad up a little bit, and she wanted to give me a preview of what you guys can get. Now look, I got some great candy, also some other cool things for men, and plus I guess she knew I like candles. She obviously went all out for this basket, trying to put on a good show for me, and she did. So everybody that is associated with Raising Grace Studio will be getting one of these gift baskets for the holidays, and I recommend you guys get them too. Now she told me this is one of the more expensive ones, but if you don't feel like spending a whole lot of money on one, she's got some for around 30, 40 bucks as well, and she can supply your whole office, your whole school, whatever. So, Miss Vicky at Dolly's Delights, thank you. If you want to get in touch with her now, call her at 478-231-7237 or go visit her at 5122 3rd Avenue, Eastman, Georgia. Now, a couple days ago, I did a show with Miss Lori from Lori's Dive-In over in Alamo. She brought me and Gracie all types of food, even a keto pizza, a cauliflower pizza. I've never ate anything like that before in my life. And let me tell you, it was banging. The wings were amazing. She does this special mix-up with lemon pepper and buffalo, and it's out of this world. Her wings are cooked better than almost any place I've ever been. Let's see, what else did she bring us? She brought us fried Oreos. She brought us fried pickles. The barbecue was awesome. The hamburger was banging. When you go there, too, folks, you can go back and listen to the whole episode between me and her. Her staff is awesome. You feel like you're at home. It's just the best little place around. I know whenever we go through Alamo or I'm going down 16, I'm going to divert myself to go get lunch there. Y'all, please go check her out. Her phone number is 912-568-1645. It's on Commerce Street over in Alamo. You can't miss it. It's Lori's Dive-In. Go get fed good. Go get treated good. You're not going to get better service from better people anywhere around here. So go check her out now.
Thank y'all for listening to the Josh Terry Podcast. I want to give a big thank you before we start the show. They're going to be on the show tomorrow, but I want to make sure I don't say it wrong. They're a sponsor for the show this month, but it's Alive and Well Hydration. Justin and Jason, thank y'all very much for being a sponsor this month. But they just came and hooked me up with all kind of fluids. Gypsy, too.
Woo-hoo.
And I feel pretty fucking good. I'm not going to lie. With me on the show today for our fourth day of Christmas is Gypsy, Neil Mullis, and Cam Harden. I'm glad y'all come hang out for a little bit. Now that we're done talking shit about women that have been on Yellowstone, we can get down to business.
It could probably be its own show.
I can talk some Yellowstone. It's one of the few shows. I'm just a big Kevin Costner fan, though. Like, I like anything that Kevin Costner does. I just think he's the fucking GOAT.
We've talked about this.
Yeah. Kevin Costner is just a G to me. I'd rather watch him and Robert Duvall. Robert Duvall is always going to be like my one.
Gus.
Because I'm a Lonesome Dove fucking fanatic.
Same.
Yeah. I was talking to somebody about that earlier. Somebody sent me a quote from Lonesome Dove earlier trying to get my attention. And I was like, that's the way to go about it.
I hate rude behavior in a man.
A boy.
Dominated.
Man, shit. What did this girl say to me earlier today? Let me find it. Oh, yeah, because I quoted on the fucking show all the time. It's if you want one thing too badly, it's bound to be a disappointment when you get it. Yeah. He's talking about buttermilk and all that type of shit and everything. If you want it too much when you get it, it's bound to be a disappointment. God, I like that shit. But anyway, so I invited all y'all out today. Neil called me at lunch. And I guess it wasn't lunch. It was lunch for me.
Ish.
Yeah. But anyway, so I go through my little pissy spells. And lately, I just keep finding myself like being just more of a fucking asshole. And people just rubbing me wrong. And so I figured, like, on the show today, we could kind of talk about it. Because Neil wanted to know, like, right off the bat who I was talking about. And it is someone in particular, but it's also a generalized statement. So I'm going to read some of it, and we'll talk about it, and then we'll just fucking snowball. So I put on Facebook last night, a selfish person will always be spotted in a room full of selfless people. The second I realized that you only think of yourself and that you only have your best interest at heart, I will cut you off without explanation. There are too many good people in this world. There's a lot of them in this room right now. To be surrounded by people that will stab you in the back just to get what they want, especially when you have people that will sacrifice themselves for you. You don't have to keep your circle small, but you do owe it yourself to keep it honest. And I started getting messages from folks whenever I post that or whatever. They automatically want to know who the fuck I was talking about, one. But second, it was just where I didn't realize a lot of people put up with other folks that they don't have to. And they don't know how to, like, break it off with them. So, like, every once in a while, people will ask me, like, my advice on that. How if you got somebody toxic in your life to get fucking rid of? And, like, I want to be the most toxic one of all my friends. Neil, I probably owe Neil more than fucking a lot of folks. He's helped me out with a lot of shit. And it seems like every time he asks me to do something, I end up being a shitty friend and not helping. look at him. He's like, yeah. I'm just not good sometimes at keeping up with shit.
Some of the things I ask you to do are beyond your capability.
You're mainly being asked to come here for moral support.
Yeah, see, he knows I'm not a man.
Is it like math homework or something?
It's like manual labor.
Oh,
yeah, pretty much anything manual.
Yeah, he knows that I am a bitch. But there's also been times like he's invited me to do fun shit, and then something comes up where I can't do it. I don't know. I feel like that's, I'm a shitty friend sometimes for that stuff. But
most of the time it's just to come eat.
Well, you do cook for me. You've cooked for me a lot more than I've cooked for you.
Yeah.
And I appreciate
it. But you are doing some damn good cooking. I thought, aside from the greasy-ass hot dogs you cooked the other night, some of that shit you cook on Snapchat, if you ever fail at this, I know what your second job could be.
Being a fat-ass
Was that the one with the onions?
Yeah.
Yeah, what do you mean greasy-ass hot dogs?
I
can
eat like straight onions.
You don't like onions?
No, bread,
I love
meat,
onions.
Ketchup.
I don't like onions unless they're fucking almost burnt. I can't. They have to be almost burnt, and they're really good then.
But you have what a lot of men like myself don't have, and that's creativity.
Yeah.
See, if I'm in charge of cooking supper, it's pork chops and beans. I mean, that's
nothing wrong with that. That
barbecue.
Sounds...
Maybe I want to get frisky, a little barbecue sauce.
I had to learn how to cook. I just had to learn how to cook because, you know, you get stationed a lot of places where you can't have a grill outside on your patio, or you can't have this in apartment complexes and stuff. So I had to figure out how to get good with a frying pan.
Well, I had Gracie's mom for the longest time, and that bitch couldn't boil water. Like, so I already liked cooking, but I had to learn how to do a whole lot more. And now I'm actually pretty good.
I used to watch those, videos of Gordon Ramsay.
Yeah.
When he was just cooking in his kitchen in the house, and I was like, damn, he makes it look easy.
It is fun when you have the space. Like,
how do you cook in your van?
I usually just go out to eat once a day. But if I do, I have a burner in there. So if I need to cook something, it's usually oodles and noodles. That's why I'm so skinny.
That sounds horrible.
But if I have
a place.
I love
noodles. Don't get me wrong. I just couldn't eat
it for
every meal.
Like when I go up to Maine and I have like my daughter's house or my ex-husband's house or whatever, I'll go in there and fucking cook up a storm all week.
I say I would cook for you again, but I cooked for you last night and you burped and farted on me.
I farted on you every night this week.
That's a compliment.
I have farted on every
night. I don't know what made me sick last night as we were sitting here doing
like a live. It was probably my burps for sure.
And that fucking something hit my gut horrible.
It was the tequila too. You had some tequila last night.
I do like tequila.
Don't you dare blame
the tequila. Tequila usually don't fuck me up that bad. It was a smell.
It was probably my breath from your burgers.
They were good burgers though.
They were. I kept burping it up. I was like, whoof. For sure.
Anywho, back to the topic at hand to start off with, because I don't know how the fuck we just...
Now I'm hungry, too.
Yeah, we just went... Yeah, that's exactly what I'm sitting my fat ass over here thinking. I was like, do I really want to record a show, or do I want to go to La Cabana and get some tequila in me? A
little bit of both.
Yeah. It'd be just nice once, because I about even just said this idea. I was going to be like, hey, I'll buy dinner for everybody. Let's go get a margarita and some food from La Cabana. But you know what happens? Mm-hmm. Every time I say that I'm going to do like a few minutes of a show or half a show, then I'm going to go have a couple drinks and come back and finish the show.
You never
finished
the show after.
I've yet to do it.
No.
That idea has happened 10 times. There's even a couple shows that I only uploaded half of it. Because once I start, I can't stop. I go down a very dark road very quickly.
Yep.
Yeah. But anyway, selfish people. Me. So I'm gonna throw out something to you guys, and I want to get y'all's opinion on it because this is kind of where it came from. So I recently got a deal. I shouldn't say a deal. I recently came into an agreement with Live Oak up in Nashville, and I don't want that deal fucked up or whatever. So like, there's people around us that maybe or maybe not 21, and the owner. I don't want to put them in a bad situation to where like they could lose their liquor license or get in trouble because of me. So I've told people, don't give a fuck what you do. Don't go to Live Oak.
Right.
And then you kind of find out that people might have went to Live Oak. And that's where I'm like, you know what? When folks, they're just so fucking selfish. They don't think about like you on a business. They'd rather have fun.
Right.
Like you've been there for folks. You've helped folks. You know, I'm starting to get now to where I'm just cutting people off left and right.
You have to.
The people that I like are in this room, and I got some more folks that obviously can't be here. But and I'm going to call some of my buddies out right now. The other night for one of my buddies, we went on a golf trip last weekend. We ended up going to Kerrigan's. Some of my buddies got kicked out. And it's like, my fucking name's on that back wall. Like, if I was going to do any concerts or any events here, like, I just got to watch it. Like, I love those folks, and I hate that they got kicked out because I don't even think it was their fault. But there's times that I have to sit down and I got to shut up even when I want to speak up because I don't want to fuck up one of my friends.
Right.
And, like, I just don't think a lot of people have that mindset. They'd rather make themselves happy or do what they think is right.
Is that maturity or is it literally just good sense?
I think it's good sense. And it's the fact that if you know you're with somebody that's offering you to come with them and hang out with them. I mean, I say things that are wild and crazy sometimes, but I also kind of monitor how he's acting in a room or my friends in general are acting and how I should kind of behave, even though I'm a wild child. I kind of know how to limit myself on these things.
I think that's common sense. Cause
yeah,
I grew up, you know, we all grew up in small towns. Yeah. I was being like in a family that was kind of in the small town public eye, he had to be very cognizant of
what that means.
You had to make sure that you weren't fucking up all the time. Right. Like you had to be very careful. I mean, and it was a small town and everything is, it's not even perception. What it looks like is what it is. And there's no way to prove it wrong or right. So at some point you had to establish a pretty good sense, you know, and I think that the maturity part of it probably comes when you recognize when people don't have good sense to kind of separate yourself from them, try to help them.
Yeah,
you try to, but it's condescending sometimes when you try to calm people down.
I got certain friends that I would take with me to Nashville to be in certain rooms with me, and I got some that wouldn't, and I hate that because like the people that I wouldn't, people I have amazing times with here, and I feel like it makes me look like an asshole.
No,
like that I don't invite people to certain places. Yeah, that's how I've kind of felt lately. Like, oh, I'm kind of a dick. I haven't invited this person to go do this with me. But then, like, I don't want to be looking over my shoulder the whole time. Like, what the fuck are they doing?
You want to think it's just a conversation away with that person that it would solve it, but it wouldn't. It's not.
It's never. Because
those are the kind of people you don't want in your life then. If you cannot sit down and have a grown-ass conversation with a person and be like, hey, I want to invite you to this. Unfortunately, these actions are... And if they don't accept that as a conversation, they're not a true friend. A true friend would be like, oh my God, I didn't mean to upset you or I didn't mean to cause that for a problem for you.
I tried to have a grown-ass conversation with somebody the other day, a younger lady. Boy, let me tell you, I realized right then I can't be around this fucking person. No offense, Gypsy. Women are already hot-headed as fuck anyway. Oh, your phone's going off. I thought he was asking for a beer.
Anyway,
I couldn't even talk to this, like, give this person my opinion.
That goes back to maturity again.
Yeah, and this is like, why the fuck are you around me then? I think a lot of people around here don't like me anymore, or that used to be what we considered friends. I get it all the time. It's like, oh, you think you're better? No. You can come hang out at the studio. You can do stupid shit with me whenever you want to. But I'm not going to put you in a situation where it's going to make me look stupid. But I think I might have used to been that way. I think my buddies, and like the first time that I got super fucked up and I was in Nashville and I was talking to Ashley McBride for a few minutes, I had to have like somebody pull me away because I was slurring. And they was like, dude, you can't do that. Like, it can't be aggravating. It gives you, ever since then, it took one time with me, though, to not want to do it anymore.
That's smart. The smart ones learn from either one mistake, but the really smart ones learn from other people's mistakes.
Well, I think it's different when it's business. Like, I'm trying...
I was going to get to that. Totally different.
Yeah, like, I'm trying to have fun, but also, too, Neil and me have been shit-faced in this room recording shows. I can get him fucked up as he wants to be. He's not going to say anything to fuck me up on the show. He might have said one slick thing one time that was really, really funny. You remember, it was something jockey. And we were talking about some... Do you have any idea what I'm talking about?
Oh, a camel jockey.
Yeah, there you go. Say it again. It was good. It was very good. But we've made a lot of edgy jokes on here. We've talked a lot of shit on here. And I think it's fine. But it's different when it's on here. I wouldn't even think Neil would do that if we was in public.
I would.
Never mind.
I wouldn't say something I wouldn't say to your face.
You're right.
I'm the same way.
But like, you wouldn't do... Okay, let me put it
that's
that
way. That's hard for me to
people,
do.
There's a particular group of people in the world that hate us.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how nice we are to them, they hate us. So why the hell would I feel bad about calling them some derogative name? There's no telling. I don't know what they're saying, because usually it comes out. I mean, you know, I don't know what
they do. They call what?
You know, they chop their
Swahili?
Lips.
Swahili?
You
know exactly what he just said.
Yeah. So anyway, there's a lot. There's a group of people in the world that hate us that we haven't done a damn thing to. Me personally, I haven't. I don't know what they up in D.C. did to them, but I ain't done shit to you.
Okay, well, let me say. Let me say this a different way then. If you was in a room with one of the veteran organizations that I work with, though, and you saw someone there that might look like one of these people, you wouldn't just outright be ugly to them, though.
I wouldn't be ugly to them unless it fit their profile.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying.
If they're not a
kid. But I don't even think that if it was in a room that was more business than fun, I still think you would bite your tongue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, sitting around talking shit, drinking, it depends on who's around. If
that's what I mean.
If everybody's being honest and everybody kind of knows, you know.
Yeah. You wouldn't – when I, like, you – even if we put the roles in reverse and you was like, hey, Josh, we're having a Christmas party for your job. And I got there and it was somebody that I completely despised or hated there. You would expect me to be on my best behavior because it was work related around you.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not going to tell my boss, hey, you egotistical son of a bitch, what we're going to do about our holiday pay this week?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not going to. Yeah. But naturally, business is business.
Yeah.
But if we're sitting around just talking shit, then.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I meant. Like, you're not the one that's going to jeopardize somebody else's career.
Unless they ask me.
Okay. I like that about him.
That's a pretty good stance.
That is. Hey, I like that.
What was it that time that we was
I'm
doing
I'm not going to give my opinion unless you ask it.
There
but don't ask it if you don't want the
that's
100%
exactly right.
truth.
If you don't want to know what I think,
that's a tough one, too,
because
I'm almost overly nice because I've been in customer service and stuff for so long. It's a thing that gets inside you. You don't know how to get out of it. The only time that I've realized that I've flipped my asshole switch and, like, revert back to just military and just want to lose it on somebody is someone in customer service.
Yeah.
And if they're doing a shit job, I just want to punch them.
Me and Gracie
punch
have this conversation so much. She gets mad at me the way that I conduct myself at restaurants. Like, but those people are in customer service to me.
Yeah. I mean, I worked in bunch of restaurants in college.
And it's like
you gotta have a thing.
You can't have a shitty fucking attitude.
No.
And regardless of what customers, like, if I was your boss and I saw you fucking acting this way while you're serving my food or taking my order or whatever, I would fire your bitch ass in a heartbeat. And Gracie, I'm trying to teach her, you don't have to put up with that.
Another aspect on that too, because you really don't know what somebody is going through at that moment in time. They could just be having a really shitty day. Their mother could have died that day.
I'll tell you
stuff
what,
like that.
You're right about that, but go to Subway in Cochrane any day of the week.
No.
Or McDonald's.
Or McDonald's.
Well, no.
There's not a fast food place here in Cochrane. You go to DGR's, you're going to get treated okay. You go to Scott's, you're going to get treated great. Shout out to Jess Darcy.
Where does it end, though? Because if somebody's having a shit day, that's because somebody else ahead of them cause them
day.
To have a shit day.
You're right.
So eventually, you got to just nail it down. Somebody woke up and chose to be a dickhead.
You're right. And a lot of people choose to be a dickhead.
They have fucked up everybody else's.
But then are they supposed to be nice to us if we come in there and we're having a shit day, though?
No, I wouldn't put up with it.
Yeah, so if you're in customer service, I think that shit's supposed to go out the window.
That's part of your job, though.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the way I look at it.
That's what separates the men from the boys, women from the girls.
Right.
Proud of few. If you're in customer service, you know.
You were trying to think of a way to say them other ones. I was.
When you're in customer service, you have to know
the
that
camels
half
from
of
the
your,
jockeys.
Half of your phone calls are not going to be good.
Oh, God. I've got to be the worst person ever if I'm pissed off and I have to call, like, Verizon or anywhere that you're not going to talk to somebody who speaks the same language as me as their first language. I'm telling you. I wouldn't want to. I wish there was a button that when you call a company like that, it just says, look, I'm a dick. Just let me talk to someone in English.
Yeah, nothing against your nationality.
Yeah, no, no. Let somebody that speaks your language or let somebody who's not a dickhead talk to you. Mm-hmm. Don't let me talk to you.
You might be buying something you ain't got a clue what the hell they said. You just, right. I mean,
I don't understand.
Depends on how your day's going. If you're like frustrated when they always, and you're ready to get it over with, yeah. Go ahead, yeah.
They
yeah,
always give you a name that you know damn well ain't their name.
Oh, yeah.
Now you're speaking
fucking
with
Habib
speaking
is
with
like,
Matthew.
My name no, is Jack.
No, it's not.
No, fuck, your name is not Jack.
That's right.
Yeah. Like, Neil's like, do you know that motherfucker wrote his camel to work?
Equifax. 2 years ago, Equifax locked my credit down. They locked it down.
Why?
I don't know. We still don't know. And let me tell you, Equifax, that's a bitch to call. That, I mean, to get in touch with anybody that speaks English is a son of a bitch. But I tried. I called every 1-800 number that they had on the website. And I called the Atlanta office and got in touch with the security guard. I'm desperate. I was trying to buy a truck.
Yeah.
And when the credit union run my credit, it just showed dashes, zero, like it was gone.
Yeah.
I was like, wait a minute now. I paid my bills on time. My shit's good. Why is my credit locked out? And like you said, somebody that can't speak a lick of English, every time I call, I talk to them like, look, I'm sorry. I'm losing my patience here, so don't take this the wrong way. I need English. I need to talk to somebody that speak English. And they transfer me. I mean, this is a week I go through this shit. And I'm finally like, I swear to God, if you're not a manager, I'm hanging up and trying again.
Boy, you know what gets me about them too? Is you tell them I want to speak to your supervisor, they transfer you to the motherfucker sitting next to them.
Yep.
And you know good and damn well, all you have to do is speak to a superior of theirs, and they're going to fix whatever is wrong. Anytime I've actually got to somebody that was a manager or a superior or whatever my issue was that I knew that could be fixed, was fixed.
Ironically, mm-hmm. It was a Karen.
Yeah.
Like, I always found my way to a Karen. She's like, I got this. Click, click, click. See you later.
Yeah.
She hates her job. She don't want to talk to you, but she knows what to do.
It's like a four-minute job. Click.
Yeah, I've had to go through that shit with the studio with PayPal. Let me tell you, calling PayPal might be the worst shit on the planet. They decide, oh, no, we're not only going to freeze your PayPal account, but we're going to freeze your bank account that's linked to it, too.
You guys are not my pals at all.
No.
It's a shit name.
Yeah, have you ever dealt with this?
No.
PayPal, because it's linked to your bank account. If they find a problem with what you're doing, they will report and lock their account, your PayPal account, but then they'll call your bank, or they'll do something to where the bank freezes your card.
See, I don't do much through PayPal. I think Uber's. That's it.
Yeah, fuck PayPal.
Yeah.
If you're listening to this, though, keep my account open. But no, because anytime I do something, people send you money on there or whatever. It happened earlier this summer. Somebody sent me $1,500 for something. I can't remember what it was. And they sent it as friends and family. Or they sent it as a reverse. It's goods and services.
Right.
So, because I didn't put a tracking number in, or I didn't tell with PayPal whatever the fuck that money was for, they were like, no, we're locking it down. And it's like, motherfucker. What? I mean, with this show, there's people that pay me for advertisement spots.
Right.
Like, I shouldn't have to tell you every time something's sent to me. I shouldn't provide you an invoice, and I'm providing the company with or the people that. It's just fucking stupid. And explaining that to someone that does not speak English is a
bitch. What the fuck
bitch.
Is it like IRS agents that moonlight as PayPal accounts?
I got scared as fuck when I got here today because I had a letter from the IRS.
Cool.
Yeah, you never want those, right? No. As a business owner or just whoever, you just don't fucking want one.
Letter, by the way.
Yeah, it was a letter.
They don't call you if it's really the IRS. They don't call you. They do send you a letter.
Yeah. Sent me a letter and they was like, by the way, Mr. Terry, if you would like us to help you get health insurance, we will. And I was like, I'm good.
Oh, that's good. Maybe I got one too. I won't freak out so bad.
I saw it and I was like, God damn, it ain't even the end of the year yet. I haven't even filed my taxes.
I've already paid half of my taxes.
We paid them last year. Well, me having a business though, I can claim a loss for like 3 fucking years. And honestly, it's been a loss with everything I've had to spend to this point. So I was like, okay, I hadn't even told y'all this year how fucked I was. But you're already just sending me something. And then I was like, no, we'll help you with your insurance. I can't wait with all these IRS agents that were just hired. Wasn't like 70,000?
I get just nauseous when you talk about taxes in general. I am so sick and tired of taxes.
Yeah.
Well, you saw where... Senor Biden said the other day that if you didn't make $400,000 a year, that you were fixing to get the best tax breaks you had ever gotten in your life.
That'll be nice.
If you fall into the categories.
If you're below another income.
He said under $400,000.
No, he jacked the taxes up on middle class, really, honestly. You're in another tax. I'm in a 23% tax bracket now.
Yeah.
There ain't no 10% no more. It's 23% of my yearly earnings go to them.
I just will never understand taxes.
God, oh, it makes me so
pissed. I hate that I went down the QAnon rabbit hole a couple years ago, and it was like explaining to you why taxes are illegal.
I don't want to get historic on you, but damn, isn't that why we left Britain?
Yeah.
Fuck.
Taxes are, by everything that is in any declaration or whatever that our country said, taxes are illegal as fuck.
I'm fine with taxes, and but to an amount. I'm fine with paying state taxes if the money goes towards roads and state parks, and I will pay to live in Georgia.
Yeah.
As long as everybody else does too.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I'll pay to live in the United States as long as everybody else does too. Where you lose me on taxes is where somebody who doesn't work gets a tax break for not working.
Y'all talk for a minute. I'm about to piss myself.
That's where you lose me.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you on that.
I'll pay to live here.
Yeah.
I'll pay, but I feel like they ought to cut it off. If you pay $10,000, that's it. That's your dues. You've done it.
Right.
Nothing more.
Right. I think it should be like 10% across the board. Everybody pays 10%. Everybody. It doesn't matter what your income is. You pay 10% of that.
Yep.
So, I'm sorry. If you make $500 a year, you're paying $50.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, $50 out of $500.
They've got
that
to
much.
The point now to where they're letting these multi-billion-dollar corporations. They have extended how many write-offs they'll let them have. If you're middle class, you take the standard deduction, and that's it.
I think churches should have to pay taxes too.
I don't.
Stop.
Yeah, you can't make.
I do.
Do you really?
Absolutely.
I think Joel Epstein. Or Olstein, where the fuck his name is, all those mega churches, absolutely. I think.
You want me to tell you how many people are really doing it for the Lord if you put some taxes in it?
Yeah.
And they gotta stand for what they're making? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have a lot less of them preachers finding Jesus.
I know. I don't think, let me make sure I say this the right way. I don't think like a Greston Baptist church or like smaller churches, I don't think they should have to pay.
The reason I think this is because I just made a statement when you were in the bathroom peeing, is the fact that I think everybody should just pay 10%. Whatever your income is, I don't care what your income bracket is.
I don't disagree with that at
all. And I think churches should have to pay taxes too, and that would be 10%.
But the reason why that doesn't work is you're going to get people that can't afford to give 10%. And so that's why they add it up to the people that make more money to where you have to pay. You have to pick up their slack.
They can afford it at the cash register.
Yeah. But we both know, or all of us know, there's a lot of people out there. They got the food stamp cards. They got the government assistance or whatever.
Right.
There's a lot of people on that shit that we have to pick up their slack. I mean,
I don't. I don't mind giving to those people. I don't mind my taxes, the federal taxes.
I don't want to give them a goddamn.
No, listen. This is my philosophy on it because I used to work 3 jobs. You should have to be at least working or really disabled in order.
Oh, absolutely.
To get. That I don't feel like you should be able to sit home and pop out 600 babies and then keep getting $600 a month for fucking your kid. I don't think that's cool.
You want to talk about starting a fucking shitstorm? When I worked in radio, we got on this subject.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know what? I'm fine with somebody getting government assistance, but there ought to be programs set up to where, let's say you're just kind of a waste of life or you can't find a good job, whatever. Somehow you got government assistance. You ought to have to do community service. You ought to have to fucking graffiti, pick up trash, all this stuff. It ought to be where, even though you're receiving assistance from the government, your community ought to be stellar.
Right.
Like it would trickle down to where, well, prisoners wouldn't have to do this. You got other stuff that'll be opened up for vets. You got other programs that are opened up. You don't have to pay prisons or whatever to go fucking clean streets or whatever it is. It would even it out to where there's probably more money in the community if you did that way.
Yeah.
And also, this is what also it would do. The people who are just lazy fucks they'd end up just having to get a job, and they wouldn't be mooching off the government anymore because they wouldn't want to do that shit.
Right.
Now, if anybody that's disabled or anything like that, like, I'm fine with government helping you.
Me too.
But we all know those waste, those pieces of shit.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, popping out babies.
It makes you question why even try. You know what I mean? Like, why even? Why? I mean, why? Because
it makes
you
a good person,
so
and you can know that you are a good person. Because,
I mean, I have worked. I have made more money in overtime this year than I have made on my straight time.
Yeah.
I feel like.
What do you end up keeping from that? Like 20, 30% by the time taxes
hit?
Fuck it,
I'll just put it out there. I've made $120,000.
Yeah.
I've netted 60.
Oof. That's fucking tough.
That is.
God damn, that's tough.
It's gross. Yeah. Get it?
Yeah, it's gross.
And it's just like, why even do it? I mean, you work extra hours to make money to bring home to save money, savings account, you know, cost of living's high as hell, all that stuff.
It's funny this song's playing.
Oh, right?
That wasn't intentional. I know. It's great that this song's actually older, though.
Like, if anybody wants to make it different, make it to where if a man chooses to work overtime, don't tax his overtime.
Right.
Because that's his extra time away from home that he's choosing to work and make extra money. It's bullshit.
To help his fucking family.
Yeah, and then I have to drive past all these other son of a bitches in the middle of the day that's just lollygagging around, swiping food stamps at the gas station for beer. That shit makes me mad.
Boy, there ain't nothing that fucking pisses me off more than, like, it's one of those slack weeks on your check. I don't think anybody in here is, I know all of us at one point in time has probably struggled financially.
Yes.
But one of those weeks where, hey, I can't buy exactly what I want at the grocery store, and you get up to that fucking checkout and you got a motherfucker that's in front of you that you know, and you know that this motherfucker ain't working. And they got lobster, they got steak, they got shrimp, they got all the stuff that I can't buy. But the government's like, here, go ahead.
Yeah, if that EBT your power bill might be a little bit high this month, we ain't gonna eat steak tonight. I'm gonna get a pack of chicken.
Yeah,
and then you got this other son of a bitch that's got a buggy full, and they bitch about. I seen this one woman. It's not been that long ago. She had a buggy full. I had half a buggy.
Yep,
it was $200.
Yeah,
God knows how much her buggy was.
Nothing.
She bitched about having to come out of pocket $10.
I'd have slapped
her. I wanted to throw the buggy at her. I really did. I just wanted to throw my buggy at her. I did.
But that's what fucking happens when the government's your daddy, though.
Selfish.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, God, that shit. I'm telling you, I get irate. I'll tell you one that's always got me, too, is I can't stand you got folks like you that have worked their fucking ass off. You got farmers.
Mm-hmm.
You got all these people around here that have just busted their ass their whole life, and you probably go get a loan, but you got like these farmers and shit that have just done so much, fed so many people, clothed so many people. They're just not appreciated for their job that they do.
No.
And they can't get fucking loans. They can't get no assistance. And they'd be the one that actually would go broke trying to pay it back and actually pay it back. But then you get these just worthless piece of shit that, oh no, we're going to give them a loan.
Here's a funny thought. If they would just let us keep what we earn, we wouldn't have to get a loan.
Yeah, but then they'd have to make their own money.
That's scary, ain't it?
They'd have to work.
Somebody would have to go to work, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Son of a bitch.
So if there's two people like you're talking about go up for a loan, right? That's the system.
Yeah.
In my head is because the people that you say are good, definitely going to get the loan, why are they going to get the loan? Interest rate.
Yep.
That interest rate is going to be sky fucking high, and the banks are going to make all the money in the world.
Yeah.
You give it to that farmer, they know farmer's going to pay it back.
Yeah.
They just know, right? And they can write it off, and it's part of a business, and it makes sense, right? So they're not going to get that much off the top. But you give it to this one person, they got 12% interest, the bank's making bank.
Yeah.
That's all. It's all one big circle jerk.
Yeah.
All of it.
I wish that somebody would come along and fucking change the system, though. I wish it would. I wish almost you could split the country down the middle. And you could say, hey, from Texas to California, well, I would want to keep Texas. But from the other side of Texas to California, you send all these people that want to live off the government. You send all these folks that just don't give a fuck about their job or whatever they're doing. Send them over there, let them do whatever, and then just give the rest of the country to us. and just let everybody work, keep what they earn, and see which one ends up being a nicer side of the country.
Well, I think you just set up the prequel to Hunger Games.
I hope it ends up being that way.
The problem is too many people have made too much money off of other people.
Right. Yeah, right? No shit. Yes.
So, you know, the railroad strike thing, right? Everybody, some people heard about it. I saw a couple TikTok videos
about it, but I didn't understand what was going on.
Well, I kept up with it pretty hard. And if you really want to know what's going on in D.C., watch C-SPAN.
Yeah.
Because it's boring. There's no reporters talking on the side. There's no interviews. It's just live feed of inside the Senate, inside the House, and all that. And everything they get on Fox News and CNN, MSC, it's a joke. Because I watched Bernie Sanders walk into Senate and meet Mitch McConnell with three bags of Subway. And you had Nancy pop in real quick and hug up on this Jordan. I'm trying to think of all the big names that go on there and say they hate each other. It's a joke. It's a show.
Yeah.
I don't want to get too deep, but if we really want to fix anything, kill the fucking two-party system.
Oh, the two-party system is all nothing but
money. It's money, money, money. Yep. It's just banks.
It doesn't make sense to me. It hasn't made sense to me for the longest time because I've seen some Republicans, some super conservative people that say shit, and I'm like, I wouldn't vote for you. Like, I don't much care for you.
Listen, the politicians, they make a living saying and doing the things that they don't even believe in.
Yeah.
They literally just picked a party. And if you pick a party, you have to believe all of the major five things in that party. And if you don't, then you're fucked. There's something wrong with you. No one's going to vote for you, right?
Look at the shit show we just went through this summer.
Yeah.
I've always voted Republican, and I will just because I can't stand half the shit Democrats do. But look at the Republicans going on a witch hunt about abortion. I'm sorry. I don't wake up in the morning and think about abortion. I don't. It's never going to affect me. I don't like it, but it doesn't affect me. As long as I'm not paying for it with my tax dollars, I don't care what somebody else
does. I'll take it one step further. I don't care about it, and I think we're all Christians in this room or whatever, but it also, like, I believe I'm not supposed to tell you what the fuck to do with your body because I don't want you telling me what to do with mine.
Exactly.
Now, you can take that however the fuck you want to. I'm not fixing to be the one that goes to a protest. I ain't finna be the one that does whatever because, you know what, you could end up saying, you know, I protest getting tattoos. I protest you drinking whiskey. I protest whatever because it ain't good for you. You don't tell me what's fucking good for me or what's not good for me.
You want to know what pisses me off, speaking of all that shit? Seatbelt tickets.
Yeah. How does it affect somebody else?
Fuck seatbelt ticket. You're going to tell me that I got to pay this seatbelt ticket and a dude just passed us on a fucking motorcycle.
Yep.
With no helmet on.
Why is my safety that important to you?
GSP is the only ones that will actually pull you over and write one for that. Every other cop, it's just a way to pull over a suspicious person.
I got a ticket about Austin. Right. That ticket at the time ran about $15. Yeah. Now, if you let that run up by the time before, you know, your court date, and you don't pay that by the court date,
I've had one spiked down
to $300.
Mm. Holy shit.
From $15 to $300 for not having a seatbelt. And I was in a four-wheel drive pickup truck. You know, back in the day, that was a law. You didn't have to wear a seatbelt if you were working, you know, pickup
truck.
It's like a farmer law.
Aggravates the fuck out of me is your insurance. Like, I think that insurance ought to have a base to where if I say, hey, look, yeah, I get if there's a lien or something on it. Like, I get something like that. But if you got a paid-off vehicle or whatever, I think most places you can just have straight-ass liability or whatever. But it ought to be so fucking cheap. I know some people that's got some monster-ass tickets on their record from back in the day. And this almost like, at one point in time, because I had a DUI when I was younger, my insurance on a paid-off vehicle was as much as the truck payment on the fucking vehicle when I first got it. There's too many people making money off of what-ifs, is
all
what
in
I mean.
The system. Yeah, you know, like, what else makes a lot of money? Incarcerated people.
Oh, fuck
jails,
yeah.
Jails, prisons.
Oh, yeah.
Just getting people into that prison. Just getting people into the jail is money. Money in the pocket. Money in the community.
We just live in a very fucked up country.
The whole thing is just upside down.
You ever seen, I can't remember, Jeff Daniels is in the movie, I think. But I kind of looked into it after I saw it.
Dumb and Dumber?
That's about what we live in. But no, it's talking about how all these people say that America is the best country to live in.
Oh, that was a TV show. Shit, what was it called? He was a news anchor.
Yeah.
It's so true, though.
Yeah. And I thought about it after I saw it.
That's a good show.
I thought about it after I saw it, and I started
looking. Aaron Sorkin was the producer and writer for that one.
That was a good one.
Dude, as much as I love the fact that we do live in a freer country than most places, you start looking at the shit that we've got to pay to be, say that we're free.
Bro, I've been all over this world a couple of times, all right? And I got to tell you, we ain't that fucking free.
No. Yeah.
Well, right? I don't see
how
we are.
I've been to Amsterdam, all right? Dude's walking down the sidewalk, smoking a J, hitting the line, and then walk in and just get with a prostitute in the red light district and walk out and go to a sex show after.
Amsterdam.
And they're just having the time of their life. And ain't shit going on. Ain't nobody shooting each other up. Yeah. Ain't no crazy shit. I was like, fuck, man.
Well, I don't think we have the crime that we have here if fucking everything didn't cost so much.
I gotta wear a fucking seatbelt and this dude is getting high and banging strippers.
Yeah. God, that sounds like a good time. But no, like, I think sounds that's like where you got.
I'm sure it's a good time. I wouldn't know.
Oh, that sounds like a good fucking time.
I don't know about that. The way your face just looked.
it's too much.
She was a nice lady, okay?
They're always nice for a little while.
Nice. Speaking of not being able to speak English, that kind of worked in our favor. Next topic.
What worked in your favor not being able to speak
Amsterdam.
English?
Amsterdam.
It just was straight. Hey, just pulled out money and it went. That's straight to the show, man.
You got some corners in making. Like, they don't care what you can speak.
Corners.
Corners.
Just go to Macon. What's this, Bass Pro Shop? What $20 going to get me?
This is Hose Shop. Yeah.
You know, nobody knows what the mayor's name is or the chief of police or the sheriff, but everybody knows who the fuck Leon Jones is.
I don't know who Leon Jones
is. The corner.
Oh.
His name's on 13 every morning. Leon Jones.
He's a big deal.
Yeah, so, I mean.
Somebody just got their fucking head blown off on Tuesday at some bar up there.
We got Leon live on the scene. Leon, what you got? I got another body. I'll be back in 10 minutes.
Macon is rough. I think I'm still moving up there. I had to move the studio and everything there just for business. Dude, it's a hard fucking decision to make.
I think Macon has got to knock on some wood. But I think Macon has digressed and it's all moving south. It went to Warner Robins. Now Warner Robins is just insane.
Well, Josh ain't gonna like what I'm fitting to say.
Okay.
But
hey, waste time, get up, turn the air up.
You look at Macon. Look at the good parts you can go and not get shot or mugged.
Yeah.
Public transportation doesn't go there.
Yeah. Only way thing I get mad about that. I agree with that. Lower
the truth.
Dude. What I don't, and once again, this is gonna make me sound fucking horrible, but like, I don't like when lower income project housing is right next to something nice, and it's not because you think that, it's not because it brings the property value down for the nicer stuff. It's how do you not expect the people that have to get up every day and struggle in life because they're lower income to look over and see a fucking $1 million mansion across the street from them? Or $1 million house or whatever. How do you expect them not to wake up pissed off every single day? Like, it's almost where, not that the county needs to be separated into two or whatever, but these, what is it called, gentrification, to where like you take a community
and you make it you raise the taxes and the property values to where it's almost impossible for people to
when
live
I
there.
Tell you in Nashville. And there's a lot of places, but Nashville is just fucking disgusting with it. You will have a house that is worth a couple $1 million. Next to it is a fucking trap house. On the other side of it, trap house. Other side of it, run-down ass house. Other side of that, $1 million home. Same fucking street. And you expect those people in the middle to wake up every day and not break in your shit? Or whatever, like, it's almost at a point to where you're throwing it in their face. And I don't like that, and I don't think that's what it's set up for or whatever, but you can't expect not to have crime. And I think that's what's happened to Macon as a whole, is they're going and they're redoing so much of it, and they're making it nice. But in the same setting, you got all these people that have to look at that shit every single day that have nothing. You're going to get that shit. That's why I think Macon is so fucking bad right now.
But the I would argue that in this world we live in right now, you can almost walk to every corner of a major city and find a $20 an hour job.
Yeah.
Because nobody's working.
If you ever wanted to, if you ever wanted to kind of look at something and project where something's going economically, look at like Detroit. Used to be the monster.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Everything came out of there. GM, Ford, all of it was boom, right? And then the middle housing that was old, right? All those people died and left it to nobody. So then other people came in to those areas, and then it started to just literally implode from the inside out, just crumble. And that's what happened to Macon, and you can almost trace it back to whenever they decided to build the outdoor mall, Riverside Crossing, right?
Well, it took everybody up.
When the mall left, yeah. Macon crashed.
But you have families that go, because Macon Mall, y'all remember, y'all grew up same time, yeah, same age. Christmas time,
banging.
Macon Mall.
Yeah,
absolutely. That's where you went until people started getting shot in the middle of the day.
Yep.
People started getting shot and killed, gang violence.
Rolling in.
And you can't expect people to, it's the truth.
Well, what's.
So they built another mall.
That's it. I said this to Gypsy the other day. I was trying to explain to her like where we're from. We get called racist all the time, but it's not racist. It's we hate ignorance. Yeah. And it just happens to be that a certain group of folks, and I'm not talking about African American, I'm just talking about lower income. Like, because I know somebody's going to take that shit and try to twist my words. Lower income folks that don't want anything better for themselves usually end up being the ignorant ones that we get mad at. And then it's like, oh, y'all are racist because you're saying this about whoever. And it's like, no, we're not. It's those are the ones that are acting fucking stupid. You don't see that. You really don't see that on the other side from middle class and up or whatever. And in Macon, everything that is around the old mall is lower income. So you get fucking all these folks in there that are just ignorant and stupid as fuck. And they're in there showing out. And that's why you get all that. You don't get that. Have you ever heard of a shooting at shops at River Crossing in Macon?
No.
I haven't. I'm not going to want to, because I go there a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't. So if you look at the actual area.
Well, it's not easy just to get to. It's not just like you can walk a mile down the road or pull out a mile down the road and get there. You actually have to try to get there. You have to spend a little time and effort to get there.
Oh, you'd have to put in effort to go to a nice place?
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
For the record, I miss mall culture.
I did too.
Dude, I
used to love going to the mall.
Well, we wouldn't even buy anything because we couldn't.
Yeah.
You know, so we'd go in there and you get some Chinese food, ride the carousel, and go to American Eagle.
Yeah, yeah. Macon Mall had the baddest fucking arcade.
Oh, yeah. Dude,
I was gonna say arcades.
I fucking
and, like,
remember it.
You know, they had the coolest shit.
Yeah,
but they, you know, people fucked it up.
I thought it was like a palace, a wonder, because it was double decker, right?
Well, everybody's got to remember, like when your parents or your grandparents said, "Hey, load up, we're going to the mall today." That was a fucking
school
day. Yeah, that was a day, dude.
You went to Warner Robins.
Yeah, Warner Robins Mall's always kind of slick.
It's
Dublin, better than Dublin.
Dublin,
Mall,
yeah.
Oh, yeah. I don't even know how that place is still there.
Peons.
Well, I don't know fucking what is keeping that place in business.
And then I hit puberty, and I can't go buy clothes at a mall. So it really doesn't matter how nice it is or it ain't.
Yeah, but it's still, like you said, the mall culture. Like,
yeah.
That was fun.
Yeah,
I mean, it just going around is bullshitting all day.
My grandma and them used to be a part of a mall walking group.
What was the hat place?
Lids.
Hat Shack?
The old one,
Hat Shack.
Where you went to go get the cool,
fitted hat. Yeah, if you wanted a hat back in the day, you had to go. Now, I don't know what the fuck is
it. I think Amazon, man. I'll be honest with you. Online shopping has fucked up the mall culture.
I think Amazon is fucked up everything, but I'm glad they did, to be honest with you. I hate that some of the mom and pops are getting fucked, but I think it's a generational thing now because you have so many people that have online shop. I ordered shit this week from that Backroads apparel company. It's got the Slap Dick Cattle All that kind of stuff. They got the hat that Coe Wetzel's had on here recently. It's called Eaton Bush 69 Back Road Apparel and all that kind of stuff. I think that it made, with social media, the mom and pops are doing better now than they probably ever did before because they don't have to have a storefront.
Yep. They don't have to pay a rent.
Yeah, they don't have to. There's that good side of it. Mm-hmm. But the people that are still having storefronts, Amazon and everybody else has fucked them. I feel bad for people, mom and pops, that have to have a brick and mortar.
If I go to a store, they should literally just call it the fitting room because I will go there just to see what fits me. Yeah. I will go back home and order it online. Or literally right there in the store, I'll order it on my phone.
Well, some things you don't want to buy online. I mean, yeah. I'll give you like, so I have a big face, sunglasses. It'd be really hard for me to buy a pair of sunglasses online.
That's true.
Because I want them to fit. You know, I can buy a hat, cap, or...
Yeah.
That one's tough for me.
Sometimes I can buy a shirt. Yeah,
see, Cap's got, man, if you're a hat person, they got to fit like money.
Once you figure out your style and what fits you, you're fine with it. But I got to almost try hats on in person. I can't believe I got drunk and ordered two the other night.
I buy everything in person because I have no place to ship it. So,
oh, that's fucked up. I didn't think.
Yeah,
about
so
you being
I go when I go to those mom and pop shorts.
It's funny you say
because
that.
I totally have to get things there. So,
I read Matthew McConaughey's autobiography, Green Lights.
Yes, it's so good.
So cool.
I'm a big Matthew McConaughey
fan. So cool.
Fan,
but he went on like a huge trip where he would just travel the country. And what he would do is if he would have to meet with somebody or pick up a package or mail or something, he would have it addressed to the place that he was heading.
Yeah.
And he would just drive there and pick. I was like, that's fucking genius.
It is genius if you know where you're going next. I never know where I'm going next. I'm just, I wing my
is
whole
a cool
life.
Motherfucker to me.
Yes.
Ironically enough, well, Josh knows this, you don't, but ironically enough, I've always liked Matthew McConaughey, but I really gained a lot of respect from him after he gave his speech at the White House on gun control.
Yeah, I didn't see that.
Dude.
I can imagine what it was, though.
All his shit's good. All his speeches and stuff. He's a deep thinker.
He's one of those that he doesn't care anymore, I don't think. And that's where I always like when somebody, Joe Rogan calls it fuck you money.
Mm-hmm.
I like it when you reach that point and you could, Jason Aldean and his wife Brittany have just got to it. They don't give a fuck. And for somebody that is a musician to act the way that they're doing and put stuff on social media, it makes me like them so much fucking more than I ever did before. And I already like Jason Aldean anyway.
Yeah.
But I'd fucking, it's like, okay, you got fuck you money. Mm-hmm. So Matthew McConaughey, you know he's had fuck you money for a hot
minute. I've always been completely against gun control, but I've always had my stance on it. And he got up there on that White House stage and said, everything I think, like every thought in my head, he said it to everybody.
Yeah.
I'm like, damn.
It's
finally time somebody had a little bit of common sense.
Those sharp thoughts never come to your head until it hits your home.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And Uvalde was a... Mm-hmm. That was his home. You know, that was a big deal.
I'm sorry. There's some bitches sending me Snapchats about what they're doing tonight.
All right, dude.
Yeah. I wish y'all would have been in here, especially you, because you know them. That night that it got so heated in here, there was two people in here. Or there was a lot of folks. Matthew Burton had brought some people up here to do a show.
Shout out, Matt.
Yeah,
I love Walmart the other day.
I love Matt. He's going with us, whatever we do Saturday.
Love that guy.
So, but anyway, Matthew was starting to release that documentary or whatever on him that him and Josh had put together. And he invited a bunch of friends up here to watch it. Two of them, one of them's brother's a police officer and his dad's a fucking teacher. And the other one, we got into it and it got fucking heated. Because he was like, nobody should have guns and all this kind of stuff or whatever. And I made the joke to start off with. I was like, I think fucking babies should have guns. I was like, but seriously, all right.
Take me back to my literature days.
Yeah.
Tired of guessing your glucose levels all the time? How about a better way to manage your diabetes? Introducing the Eversense E3 CGM system, the only 6-month continuous glucose monitoring system with real-time glucose readings every 5 minutes delivered to your mobile device and exceptional accuracy over 6 months. Eversense E3 gives you readings you can count on.
For important safety information and to learn more about Eversense, visit eversensediabetes.com/safety. Accuracy evaluated in adult populations with 2 calibrations per day or less.
Call of Duty Modern Warfare is here, and so is Mountain Dew.
Roger that.
Now you can unlock in-game rewards like only Dew can.
Wait, what rewards?
A Dew Operator skin.
Man, I love Operator skins.
Dual double XP, and even Call of Duty points.
You're kidding me. Double XP and Call of Duty points? This is incredible. I can't believe it.
That's... Soldier, get a hold of yourself.
Oh, roger that.
Look for specially marked packaging and visit mtndewgaming.com for details and restrictions. Open to U.S. residents 17 plus. Call of Duty points available on 12 and 24 packs and free 20 and 23.
Get ready, Ohio. FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook, is coming to the Buckeye State. And to kick things off, you can get started with $100 in free bets as an early sign-up bonus. Plus, when you sign up today with promo code OHIOSB, you'll be all set for when FanDuel goes live in Ohio. Then you can bet on all your favorite teams and all your favorite sports with $100 in free bets. Just download FanDuel's top-rated sportsbook app. It's safe, secure, and super easy to use. Ohio, this is your chance to get in on the action. Join today with promo code OHIOSB. Make every moment more with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the NFL. 21 plus and present in Ohio. Bonus issued in non-withdrawable free bets that expire 7 days after FanDuel accepts its first real money sports wager in Ohio on 1/1/23. Unique user identity verification required. Offer ends on the go live date. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
To me, it's like this. When I've been to Texas before, okay, nobody fucks with each other out there because they're all scared that somebody's gonna fuck them up. The fuck around and find out factor in Texas is fucking huge.
It really is.
Ain't it funny how manners spread?
Yeah,
when
see,
you
that's my biggest thing. If you got manners and respect, I'm fucking, I don't care how different you are to me.
You got something in your pocket, I'm going to show you some manners.
Exactly, right? So that's what my point to this guy was. I think everybody should fucking have a gun, because if everybody's got a gun, nobody wants to fuck around and see if that other person's got a gun. Mm-hmm. You're not going to be ugly. You're not going to be disrespectful. It's going to be the old fucking West. And, like, that's what the guy brought up. That's what he said. He said, well, everybody's going to be killing and shooting everybody. I was like, no, fuck, they're not. I was like, because nobody's going to be intimidated. What's that old saying? God made us, God created all of us, but Sam Colt made us all equal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm all about that now. And, mm-hmm. boys, Cam, because you went to school with him, I'm telling you, I don't usually get heated during an argument like that because I'm just like, he's an ignorant fuck. I thought I was going to get up and slap him. And that ended up being the point at the end of the night, like how I ended the conversation. I was like, if I got up right now and I grabbed you, do you think I'd beat the fuck out of you? And he was like, yeah, more than likely. He's a smaller dude. And I was like, well, you know what wouldn't happen if you had a gun on you right now? I wouldn't get up and beat the fuck out of you.
I would agree with the words you're saying.
Yeah. All of a sudden, we're fucking equal. Surprise. That's what owning a fucking gun is about to me. That's what being able to carry is about, is making it fucking equal, making fair fights. And, man, that's – I cannot stand when you get an ignorant fuck about guns. I cannot stand. I'm one of those that think that there ought to be a well-vetted veteran at every single school.
Yes, I agree with that.
At every single fucking school. Somebody that you know is good to go. Make him have fucking psych evaluations every couple weeks, whatever you need to do. You wouldn't have no more school shootings if you had a fucking vet at the front of every school with a fucking AR.
Well, what's funny to me is all your courthouses where most of the time people just go pay their taxes or buy their car tag. You have to go through two armed guards and a metal detector.
Yeah.
To go get your car tag, pay your taxes.
You ever been to a courthouse where they only accept cash? That's the dumbest shit I've ever heard
County,
in my life.
2019.
They only accept the cash?
Dodge was like
cash
that.
Cash check.
Dodge was like that for a long time.
I didn't know that.
They had an ATM right there in the courthouse. And guess
Fort Riley's
where all
like that
went? Jesus Christ.
I don't go to the courthouse unless I'm summoned.
No, Kansas is like that.
Yeah, y'all don't have a courthouse no more.
Where?
Dodge County.
Well, the courthouse was there. It's bats run it.
Bat shit. Seriously, people.
I know where I get my tag at now is on the outside.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Is that why they shut it down?
Yeah.
I didn't fucking know that.
Yeah. So all that money that you were paying?
To take care of it? We come from the most corrupt county in the fucking state of Georgia anyway.
Cash only. No, not with bat shit on it.
Look at you trying to get me to move down here.
No, Dodge County has a long history of Dixie Mafia and fucking dead people voting and all kind. All right,
listen, but, man, I'll tell you that. But it's that a good at county. At one time in the 70s and 80s, due to voter frauds and politics and money, drugs, murders, per capita, like per number of people that are in your, you know, in your community, the Federal Bureau of Investigation knew exactly where Ryan, Georgia was because per capita there were more murders and unsolved problems than in New York City.
Holy shit.
Why else would they have a GBI office in Eastman of all places?
So where Eastman is, a community of Eastman is Ryan. Let me tell you, this place is smaller than all of Cochran. It's super small. It's smaller
now they got
than the
two red lights. They think they're hot
smaller
shit.
Smaller than the city of Cochran.
Yeah, red light, a gas station, and
but Dixie Mafia. You ever heard of Dixie Mafia? Mm-mm. It's a real fucking thing, and it's not just a real thing. It's like you're down here where a central of it is. A lot of people want to say it's like the good old boy system and all that kind of stuff, but the thing is, you didn't have a lot of fucked up shit happen around here growing up.
It used to astonish me when people would talk about going down to the river for the weekend or they go to the river. I was like, these people are like kneeboarding and skiing and shit on the river where there's probably just a dead body at the very bottom of it.
You must be talking about the
more
Landon
than one.
In Jackson, Georgia. Or Jackson. Is it Jackson? Jacksonville.
Anywhere from Sand Hammock down that way.
Whole crew. Whole
anyway. Hey, look, I'll tell you.
I would run with those people out there and it was not their speed.
Dibs, you ever seen that movie? It came out not too long ago. It's got Tom Cruise in it. It's called Made in America or American Made.
Yeah, no. That's when he's in the wheelchair.
No, that's when he's the pilot.
That's the 4th of July.
Yeah, the one on the 4th of July is when you're thinking of.
If it's not on Netflix, I don't watch it.
Anyway, it's a true story, but there was a pilot.
Oh, yeah.
You know
when he was running drugs.
Yeah, when he's running drugs. Yeah. So from down here, it's a fucking great movie because it's a true story.
Don't get me started on CIA.
Was it Tom Cruise or was it a different actor?
No, it's Tom Cruise.
It's Tom Cruise.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's a fucking badass movie.
True story. Well, based on a true story.
But the reason why Ryan, Georgia is even what it is because of shit like that. Dixie Mafia back in the day. Man.
There's a podcast out.
Yeah.
There is. Sunday Burton.
Yep.
You know, it originated up just north of Athens or up around that area, but I
got
real deep.
I thought it was Atlanta.
No, well, it's east of Atlanta, kind of up around Athens area up there. But I wanted to call you after I got done listening to it.
Lee Tucker tried to get me the dude who did it on the show.
And I was like, Josh, I wanted to tell you. I didn't want to, you got a good thing going here, but it would be cool to see you kind of step off a little bit and just do something a little different.
I would like to. You just would have to have what I even pitched to some older men that I know that's involved with it. I wanted to have some older men that know all about it come in here, sit down, do a show, and then me not say their name.
Right.
Like everybody had, like us do it early morning, late night, make sure them come in the fucking back door. Nobody knows what it is because there's some in my family. I shouldn't say they're in my family, but they're associated with my family.
Yeah. Just do like you do the videos and stuff.
They might
and have
not
them do it
for
at
their
house.
Safety, though. They might put not a, for their safety.
They never will.
You put a voice thing on it.
They never fucking will. No. There's men around here that you might have shook their fucking hand. If they're older and they're wealthy and you don't know where their wealth came from.
Yep.
Oh yeah.
They can't talk about it because if they say one single element of something that had gone wrong and they were the only person that knew about it, it don't matter what voice recorder thing you put on.
They're going to get in trouble.
They're done. Yeah. It's done.
But it's like a real thing that we got to grow up. What was his name? Jackson Jones. That was the sheriff that got in so much shit when we were young. We were young. And I might be saying the wrong sheriff's name. Dude won, I think, half the fucking people that voted for him was in graveyards.
Easy. Like,
There's been some good shit.
Feels like that's our last election.
What the fuck is that?
I wanted to write a movie about it. I was talking to one of my friends that's from that area, and we were talking about literally writing a movie about it.
I'm probably going to say the reporter's name wrong. No. It might have been Tom Brokaw. It was somebody big back in the 80s. It was like a big name. For some reason, Tom Brokaw's sticking in my head.
Peter
Jennings?
It
might have been him. Somebody like that. They came down and did a fucking thing on it. Back in the 80s, because it was it's a weird
Dodge
place.
County's got, and there's still a section of it now, and y'all, I know both of y'all know where I'm talking about. It's on Bill Mullis Dirt Road. There's a there's a spot back in there, and we messed up and found it by accident. It's right outside of, not Chauncey.
China Hill.
No, it's, it's been so long since I said the name. You got Empire.
Chester?
Not Chester. It's in between.
Roddy?
Yonkers?
It's not Roddy. It's in between Empire and Eastman. What's that little community?
Between right Empire and Eastman.
Greston?
Greston.
Oh, that's where I'm from.
That's my house. That's where we grew up.
I got a pistol.
Yeah, you peeing a lot.
I moved out of Dodge County, and I done forgot what Greston was.
But I was thinking a little community, but to us, that was home. As
you take Bill Mullis Dirt Road, yeah, and you go like you're going all the way towards Roddy.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a section down there that it splits off, and you think it's a dirt road, but mm-hmm, it's actually a driveway back mm-hmm into a,
yep,
I'm going to call it a meth lab.
Absolutely.
It was a lot of things.
It
if
still
it's
is.
A, if it's what I'm thinking, it's more it's, than just that.
It's still there to this
there's
day.
A lot more gets slung than meth.
Well, we.
But I don't know nothing about it.
I do.
Swear to God, I don't know anything. Well, I know nothing about it. I ain't going to talk about it.
So we always, when we rode dirt roads, we were kind of scared of getting DUI. So we always just went to Green Acres, you know,
right
there from Daddy's house, and take the loop. And yep, that was our, we go to railroad tracks, cross over, cross back over, ride through, and then go back to Daddy's.
Do y'all know why Dodge County has the most dirt roads in the state of Georgia? Why they never got paved?
I'm intrigued. They were paid to not pave them.
Yep. Dodge County, you can go from one side of our county to the next, and it's a big fucking county. Never touched pavement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Never touch it.
I always said that I wanted to create an app that was nothing but dirt road maps.
Yeah, I'm telling you, I've rode those dirt roads. It's my favorite thing to do in the world anyways, to drink and listen to music and ride dirt roads. And then anybody wants to give me shit about DUIs or whatever, I've never got one on a dirt road.
15 miles an hour, honestly.
You're not
going to
do much.
What are you going to do
it? Yeah.
Hurt yourself.
Yeah, that's it. You might hit a ditch and fuck your truck up a little bit, but you ain't going to hurt yourself.
As long as you got your seatbelt on.
Yeah. God forbid we didn't. But no, that's why Dodge County has the most dirt roads, and why you can go from fucking Milan to almost Cochran.
Hey,
and
I can
touch it.
I can even point you to a couple roads that got paved.
Yeah.
And I mean, it felt like it got paved overnight.
Oh, yeah.
Because somebody was like, oh, shit, they're onto it. We got to.
That fucking,
I could take you to a
Greston
road.
Baptist Church Road.
Greston was. I remember when
that
one got
that
paved.
Road should never been fucking paved.
I remember that. There's one over by the golf course, too. I used to take my buddy's house.
Yeah.
It's literally the width of one vehicle.
Yeah.
And it has more potholes and problems. It's like a slinky.
Let me ask y'all, have y'all ever, y'all both being from there, have y'all ever seen the mansion?
That by the golf course?
It's in Greston. So there is an old plantation house.
Somebody by the bypass?
It's deep in the woods.
Oh, no. Okay.
Okay, it's deep in the woods. But there's an old fucking plantation house that looks like Gone with the Wind. And whoever's land it is, I mean, it's probably, it's at least 100 acres. There's at least 100 acres. Yeah. And if you're saying what I think you are saying, but it's at least 100 fucking acres.
Yeah.
But it's Gone with the Wind.
Yeah.
And it is now, from my understanding, it's a place you store some shit till it's ready to go somewhere else. But back in the day, we used to ride foilers and shit religiously. And I've been back there, and I've walked in the house and looked at it. Scariest fucking thing I've ever done in my life.
Oh, I would buy it, like, in a heartbeat.
I bet you. I'll promise you it ain't for sale. Because if I could, I would.
We're not talking about haunted.
No.
No, literally dangerous.
Yeah, let me put it this way. We were kids, so they ended up leaving us alone.
Yeah, I remember that.
But we
trail cam on every corner. Yeah,
but we probably pulled up not knowing where we was pulling up, and we didn't at the time. We had heard about it, never seen it. Just thought it was this creepy ass old plantation house or whatever. We pulled up, get out, go look inside of it or whatever. I could not get 10, 15 feet in the house, and you had somebody, and I'm not talking about just with a shotgun pulling up with a spotlight. You had a couple folks that was like, oh, you got to go. And it's like y'all are kids. You know, it's fine. But whatever's in there, you don't need to fuck with.
All right, to get off the grist, and we were talking about Tom Cruise and the movie. Does anybody know what the CIA does?
What do you mean what they do?
What do they do? What's their sole purpose? What do they
fuck up tax dollars?
Do you want to go down rabbit holes or?
Sure.
Okay.
I got like a couple minutes.
I think CIA is nothing but more to manipulate our way of life, and they have all of us programmed since birth.
All right. So I've been around, and you remember all of I would call it hoopla, but it literally was a big deal about Russian collusion and votes and Russia, you know, basically leaning our election to one way or the other, right? Mm-hmm. And Americans were fucking hot, livid, right? Half the country just was like, I cannot believe this is happening. Oh my God, right? That is literally their job. We as Americans go into other countries and shift their entire elections around to fit our benefit. In what aspect of your life does the CIA do something for you as an American? What do they do
for you? They don't.
Not a goddamn thing. We are in the business.
Do you know about Project Mockingbird?
No, nothing. I know nothing about it.
Yeah, I bet you don't. Do you know about it?
No, I don't watch TV.
Okay. Project Mockingbird was what the CIA did back in the 60s when they found out about the effects of hallucinogenics, mushrooms, and everything.
Yeah. I thought we spent time about Maryland.
There's a movie about it.
Yeah.
There is. It's on Netflix.
So like,
you know, everything is on Netflix.
That's the only thing I watch is Netflix. Yeah.
So if you go by Project Mockingbird, what they originally found out by doing this stuff to where you're at now, the reason why people say mushrooms and stuff are so good now, ever since you were born, watching TV, whatever it is, it has programmed you. And you don't know you've been programmed. And then when you start doing mushrooms and stuff, it peels back everything that they've taught you. And you see the world differently.
Right. Because
that's the only reason why mushrooms are illegal.
Right.
That's the only reason why. They saw the effect. What did they used to do? Give it to like politicians, senators, whatever, back in the day. They used to get whores with Project Mockingbird to drug someone to find out what they knew, all kind of stuff and everything.
Yeah.
Our CIA is a bitch.
See, sex workers have been a business.
But
forever.
Hey, look, if y'all want to recruit me, I'm fine with that too, because I think it'd be cool to be on that side if you're listening to this. Yeah.
Sheesh, what a gig.
God, dude, it's got to be some cool shit.
Listen, I've worked with some guys that did some crazy stuff.
Yeah.
Right? I don't talk about military awards or none of that shit, but I've met guys that have gently alluded to the fact that they basically went into the country and messed up the thing, right? Yeah. That America now has to come fix.
Yeah.
And he put it to me like this. It's like a kid that his dad owns a glass shop in town. And,
kid goes around breaking all the glass.
The kid goes around just busting glass. Yeah. And all he's doing is creating business. Right. So we literally go into these countries, right? And jack shit up. And then we wonder why people don't like America.
Yeah.
We're the fucking problem. And then we go in and we're like, Star Spangled Awesome. Yeah. We're going to come in here and fix y'all shit. And they're like, please don't. Please just fucking leave. Please don't come in here.
The more.
And we're like, no, we got it.
The more I've watched the shit on how they've handled Iraq and everything. Man, I'm telling you, like I still
isn't that a good one?
I still love living in this country.
Here's you an interesting bumper sticker. All right, Afghanistan attacks the United States of America, and what are we gonna do?
Evade Iraq.
We're gonna go to Iraq.
Yeah.
Iraq. Why? Yeah. There's a connection.
There's some ties there.
There's
right?
a connection. Saddam Hussein and the Taliban. What's a Taliban? I don't know. We made that word up. Taliban.
The people who did 9/11 were not even from where we invaded.
Right, I looked into it, I quit because it just pissed me off.
Yeah, it pisses you off. That's why
I stopped watching the news. That's why I stopped doing everything.
Like I said, I quit looking at TikTok because everything pisses me. I just get mad. Look on there and I see somebody saying something ignorant. Why am I doing this to myself?
You gotta change.
You were on the wrong side of TikTok.
Mine is nothing but titties and fat asses and pimple popping and comedians. Yeah.
Mine's just dumb videos of people talking to themselves.
Oh, you don't like pimple popping? All the nasty shit you like.
Just disgusting.
I love pimple popping, ingrown hair, and ingrown toenails being pulled.
I can't do it.
I'd love watching it.
We found your kink. Ooh.
No, they don't get me hard. I sit there. I'm telling you, I will watch a pimple popping video for 10 fucking minutes.
So far, I've managed to get my feed on college football highlights and some of the best deers took. And, you know, I'm working my way up.
There's no women dancing on yours?
No, I don't want it because I don't want that shit.
You done figured out somebody can see your likes is what's done happened.
That has nothing to do with it. although that is hilarious. Wow. It's scary, but it's hilarious.
Yeah. I went back the other day and I didn't realize Gracie had to show me. She was like, "Dad, you know, part of this you can see if you don't turn it off, people can see everything you liked." And I was like, "Oh, I didn't." And then I looked and I was like, "I'm a fucking pervert."
So I'll just
I didn't realize I had a problem.
So I called Josh one day.
Oh, boy.
We had a weight shift. This is about to get good.
It is. It's funny. It's hilarious, really.
This is good.
But I called Josh one day. I said, I thought the whole cool thing about TikTok was it's not traceable. It's not like Facebook. You know, you go on Facebook, you comment on somebody's stuff. Neil Mullis commented on this. I thought TikTok was totally random stuff, right? So, I started getting kind of, you know, confident in myself. If I seen some random chick from California shaking her ass on TikTok, I'd put a little fire symbol up. Looks good. Don't mean I want it. Right. I'm not proposing.
She's fire.
Saying, looks good.
What'd your old lady do?
She liked my comments.
Okay, in all fairness,
she didn't even say a word to him about it. She went and found all his comments and fucking liked them.
Like I would say some slick shit, and then I'd get a like from her on my comment. I called Josh. Josh, I said, I'm not really meaning no harm here, but I'm feeling invaded. You know, I thought all this was just random fun, you know. People don't really pay attention to name. They look at the comments, you know. How the fuck is she able to go on there and find where I said some slick shit, you know, because I'm not trying to.
He did not say anything bad.
No,
though.
I mean, it was always like
fire symbol or something.
Okay,
like,
so my thing is, just because you're on a diet doesn't mean you can't look at the menu.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to look. I could be fucking starving myself. I'm still going to look at the menu.
Right.
Is the menu going to beat your ass afterwards? That's going to happen.
I don't have a menu beating my ass. I'm fine.
Me neither.
He called me that day, and I had to tell him how.
After he quit laughing. He laughed for like 15 minutes.
I couldn't quit fucking laughing because it was just the way.
That's just awesome. Props to her.
I commend her for having... Just the patience and the effort for one, but it was like, you know what? It's like when I leave somebody on red, or like if I really want to piss somebody off, I'd have sent them K. Like the letter K, because I know it's fucking...
The thumbs up pisses me off.
Yeah, it's something like that. Something that's just like they put their all their anger into a message, and I'm just like, okay. So like I respected the fact that she went through.
That's a lot of
work.
And
instead of her... saying something slick back to him or texting him or calling him or saying something to get home, she just liked the fucking messages.
That took a lot of work.
Or she just liked the comments.
That took a lot of work to find.
That's fire with fire. That's a good fight. That's a good problem.
That's like, I see you, motherfucker.
A little nervous.
Yeah, but what makes me feel like shit is that I'm not doing the same thing. I don't know if I'm supposed to reciprocate that shit because I know the good and damn well she'd be looking at men on TikTok. I know good and damn well she does. I don't know
for
if
the
I'm
one female
to
in the room,
reciprocate that or what? But
what
she probably knows
like
you
a,
don't know
is
how
there
to
like
look
a
it
thing?
Up.
Because I like okay, so men, I've heard men are extremely visual.
Yes, they are.
And women are emotional. Yes. Or to put some sort of, you know, slant there. Is there do women just like literally ogle over guys on videos and pictures and stuff?
Yeah, women are actually worse than men.
Because I know guys will just go
women
down a fucking rabbit hole. They'll see one hot girl and then they'll look at every single picture they got.
You got to know, and I don't know if you even seen it yet. Have y'all seen the dude that there's a warrant out for his arrest And the dude's like a fucking smokestack. Dude's a good-looking dude, tatted up, all this kind of shit. He got posted on some, whatever, like, let's just say Blakely County News, our like, police department or something. It's like wanted or whatever. The women in the comment section.
Oh, yeah.
Were, like, I think one of the things that said, approach him or do not approach him or whatever. He's liable to harm you or whatever. And the women are like, this motherfucker can harm me all they want. He can abuse me.
Women are fucking disgusting.
And like, you go through and you read the comments and you're like, God.
So,
damn.
So yeah. So, enlighten us, I guess. So, what is the thing you think women actually ogle over?
They definitely ogle over men.
He was talking about
men.
Like a girl in California shaking her ass. What is the thing? What's like?
Women definitely look at men, but the thing is, women will say things, but they're better about hiding it than men are.
Oh, absolutely.
Men,
they are.
I love men to death. Like, I really do, but I'm just giving you the female perspective on this shit. Men just aren't as slick about hiding it.
We see ball, want to hit ball. We got to let the ball know we want to
hit
it.
Ball. Exactly. Exactly.
That
looks
good.
Are,
I keep looking
women,
at it.
Well, who doesn't like simple?
Yeah.
I
What's
like
the two
simple.
Two things men notice on a woman. Two things right now. Right. One, two, three, go.
Titties,
eyes,
ass.
And personality.
There it is.
Credit score. Oh,
titties
shit.
And ass, right?
It's way off.
Yeah.
That's that.
But I'll tell you what, women think the same way in some aspects of that shit too, though. Like, we like a good looking guy. But everybody's attracted to something different, just kind of like guys attracted to something different. But women are just, we are nasty fucking creatures. But I will be the woman that will tell you that we're nasty fucking creatures.
I've heard a woman talk about she looks at a man's jawline.
I like forearms. I'm a forearm girl. But I will say, you give me a nice looking man, and I'm not pointing you out because, I mean, you're a big motherfucker and you're married. But, like, I like beers, and I like a big motherfucker. Like, I like them.
Fuck, 2 out of 3.
Yeah. I'm not offended.
2 out of 3 gets in the Hall of Fame.
But, you know.
Y'all ladies finna go look through every one of her videos.
I'm sorry.
See if you
finna
go
like
this.
Don't worry. Don't worry.
See if you put the fire emoji next to
her. So my
He's never
is,
met me before tonight. I just met him. I probably will never see him again, so don't be mad at me, wife. Please.
But that's damn right you won't.
Never argued about it. Never argued about the TikTok thing. Honestly, it's the second time I brought it up.
It's
I did
funny.
It live on air.
It tickles shit out of me.
But my thing is, yeah, that's a good-looking woman. She's a good-looking woman.
Yeah.
I'm not going to marry her. I'm not going home with her. Honestly, don't even want to put the effort into meeting another woman at this point.
Oh, I don't blame you.
You want to talk about a mind fuck? I was talking to somebody a while back, and we were talking about like a guy was getting dressed. And he was like, what do you think about this? And he was like, I don't really give a fuck. But he was like, well, what do you think girls are going to think? He's like, I'm not really dressing up for girls. And I was like, what the fuck are you talking about? Basically, guys, it was under the understanding that guys literally go out at night and they dress to impress other guys.
I mean,
to
women,
be like the number one guy in the room.
Yeah, well, you like
if you're the number one guy in the room, you're gonna get the number
thing.
One girl.
That's the alpha. That's the
Dude.
Alpha.
But
process.
That's a Joe Rogan mindfuck. You're like, oh.
So like, I'll tell you this: I started getting more attention from women when I quit fucking dressing for anybody but myself.
But yourself, yeah.
Yeah, when I figured out like I'm just gonna wear the fuck I want
so
to.
I don't really know what category. My mindset falls in, but when I get dressed up to go out, I try to wear a shirt that's
you want
not
to be comfortable.
A stain.
Yeah. You just want to be comfortable. Bitch. I know where
and
you're
I'm
going to
wear
this.
My pair of jeans I can fit my shit into that don't, you know, ain't uncomfortable.
I have wore some jeans that make my fucking nuts hurt.
Yeah, I'm not doing
but,
that.
But you know, but it makes me, I like wearing shit that looks good. I like to stand out, but I like to stand out in my own fucking way. Like, I don't want to look like everybody else in the
Same.
Room. Same. And the second that you, like, don't look like everybody else in the room, one, they're going to think you're confident for some reason. And I might be the most insecure person in the room. But they're like, oh, fuck, he's wearing that. He's having fun. He doesn't care what anybody else thinks. Mark Oriott. Mark Oriott is the dumbest motherfucker on the planet. He is incredibly talented. But if you saw the way that this motherfucker dressed when he goes out in Nashville, even when he's on stage playing, you'd be like, is this motherfucker homeless? What?
Those are the
but
best dudes.
In all fairness, he's the only one I ever made out with in freaking Nashville. So.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, Marcus.
That answers that.
Yeah, I just say, it really Fire. Don't. Well, I guess what I'm trying to say is it doesn't fucking matter.
Right.
If you dress how you want to and you're comfortable and it makes you feel good about yourself,
confidence
it radiates
is the best
to everybody else.
I don't think
else
it has
in the
anything
room
to do with how you dress.
No, it's
if people
confidence
are intrigued
no
about no you. If yeah somebody is intrigued, it doesn't matter if you're wearing a pair of sweatpants.
I don't know. I've seen women avoid Lee Tucker because he looks like a Walmart
reader. I mean,
reader
look what I wore to the – I mean, this ain't saying a whole lot for Ryan, but me and you went out to Ryan and listened
oh yeah
to Creed Fisher, and I had every Tom, Dick, and Harry and Ryan wanting to know.
You're 6'7".
Yeah, you kind of don't – you kind of
you look
out
like a professional football player.
Okay.
You're going to well get attention.
Okay. Right, but I was wearing shit that I didn't – whatever. Anyway, moving
so
on. I digress.
So
maybe that was a bad.
Yeah, it was a bad example.
That was a bad
so
example.
If you were
5'5" and dressed like that, nobody
yeah
look.
Nobody
at you
would even fuck.
Nobody
get
fucked.
Yeah, you're right.
You look. All right. Somebody told me this not long ago. There are certain people when they walk in a room, you might not know anything about them, but you think that they're something. Not that they are,
mm-hmm,
but you think that they're something. You, I could see you walking into a room where nobody knew you. The way that you carry yourself, the good dude that you are, your size, I can see people being like, that guy's got to be in the NFL. Like that guy's got to be an offensive lineman. It's just the way that some people carry themselves and the way they look.
But I played for Blackley County.
You're an attention grabber. It don't matter. You lie a little bit. I mean, you can't now. Yeah.
I always said I was a place kid.
I'm on the practice squad.
Yeah.
So it's funny you talk about fashion and things that stick out to people. I mean, I grew up rodeoing and riding horses and all, you know, and I wore Wranglers and boots every day, cowboy hats. And
I already can see that you wore Wranglers today.
Yeah, sorry. Thank you. Thank you for that.
I did notice.
But I think, Josh, every time I do this podcast, we got on the same fucking pair of jeans.
I got like this. All I wear is the Wrangler Retros or the Levi.
The one pair that I got.
Yeah, the Levi's.
Anyways, so like I dress like a cowboy a lot of times. And you got to be careful at the places that you go like that because you draw too much attention. That's the last thing I want. I don't want to go somewhere and like people ogle over shit like that.
We'll swap.
Yeah, I don't. Your size?
Yeah, because every
deal
time I go to a bar,
so
2 inches taller, y'all wouldn't fucking know me.
Point to prove.
Hey, dude, I've said it fucking there. If I was 6 foot tall, so would.
Yeah.
So would. I'm smashing. I've got like 8 kids. I'm 6 foot tall.
Listen, I realized a long time ago that I have more confidence than you probably should need. So if I was about 2 or 3 inches taller, y'all wouldn't have fucking known me.
I'm insecure. I'm insecure every time I go out until I hit this certain level of alcohol. I'm serious. Like I'm insecure
every day
of my fucking life until, and if I'm not drinking, I've got to be to where, I don't know, just the vibe hits or whatever. But usually it's alcohol.
Yeah.
Like, and then all of a sudden, it's just like, I don't care what none of these fucking people think. And like my insecurities just fucking melt away.
Why do you think I drink so much? I feel the same way. Absolutely.
Yeah, I'm always like that.
Do y'all have like a lot of styles?
Styles?
Like you go through different phases where you're like, I don't feel like fucking being that guy today. I'm going to be this other guy.
I think my clothes are so fucking out there for the majority of shit that I've got. Like right now, I got Wranglers on and cowboy boots, and I got a fucking Simply Southern Hawaiian style shirt on. I
fucking love that shirt, dude.
Thank you.
Looks like some shit that Screech Powers would have worn.
Yeah. I'm comfortable. I like it. I guess I don't think that I ever changed. I think I used to have like, okay, I'm going to a country bar. I got to wear country style shit. Or there used to be a rap bar that I used to like to go to. I'm putting my Jordans on today.
Mm-mm.
And now it's like, I don't give a fuck if I go to the opposite one of those and I want to wear what the fuck I want to.
Yeah.
I don't think my style changes now.
I have a lot of different personalities inside.
What's
me,
your style there, big fella?
Whatever fits.
Yeah, that'll do.
And
that'll do it.
So here lately it's been Duluth trading because they fit. If pants fit.
They just have good commercials.
So this is cool. I like shit you can use. If I can't use something,
you like
I'm not going to
clothing
buy.
Yeah.
No, this bitch has got a pocket for knee pads.
Of course it does.
See, well, I'm not.
I'm sure Gypsy could use those.
I've never used them. But if I had knee pads, I'll put some in there because I'm always.
Wait, hold on. You like it because it has a place for knee pads.
Man, I was excited for him to finish the sentence. Yeah.
Well, from a non-sexual standpoint,
there we go.
I'm not talking about you sucking dick and
I work on the railroad track, so I'm having to bend down and get on my knees and like work on switches and
shit. Choo choo, motherfucker.
And it would be really nice to have a set of knee pads.
Okay. I know what to get you for Christmas.
Fucking pounds.
Those remind me of, you know, what we wore in the military. Because they had those, those same
pockets. Until you said that, though, I want to give y'all a picture in my, like, because y'all can't see this. Until you said that, I thought it was a breakaway Caprice.
No, I hadn't seen those since I was in middle school.
I thought that's what it was.
But those would have zippers.
Boy, because I know he don't listen to this show. You remember Corey Hill?
Yeah.
You remember those?
He wore JNCOs.
Damn.
Dude, let me
how
tell
far
you,
back are we going?
Dude, everywhere that
you have
I've
a
ever,
chain wallet too?
Everywhere I've ever been with this man in my life. He used to be our DD all the fucking time. He would wear shorts that were made. He's shorter than me or my height. And he would wear shorts that was made for Shaquille O'Neal.
Fuck,
that's
no,
how long they were.
I can't do that.
That's how dude, capris.
My shorts go way above the knee. And I'm not talking like.
I like the short shorts.
If they're going to be shorts, that's what they're called, shorts.
I asked Gypsy yesterday. I was showing her some shorts. Rihanna has a like an underwear company for like men and women or whatever. And they've got like these fucking 5-inch inseam, silky fucking, like either you can wear them as boxers or you can wear them as like sleeping shorts or whatever. And I was like, are these gay?
And I was like, no, because
I'm
like
gonna I'm gonna order a fucking set of them. They look so comfortable.
Since we're on the topic, somebody, I had one pair of, I can't even remember the company or the brand, but there was like a pocket for the all the junk to sit in.
Duluth.
No, but it was Duluth was like to me is more functional. That makes sense for on the job activity. These were like Josh was talking about, like silky kind of like. But they had like a little pocket where it, everything just sat in there nice, like on shelf, like, and it was like, I feel so free.
Talking about your nuts and everything sitting
all
in
of
them?
It. Yeah.
Oh, it had like the built-in banana hammock.
Yeah.
But oh, I know what you're talking about. I've got a pair. It's almost like, dude, they're cool. If they're compression style shorts, but where your dick goes and balls, it's a little bit looser and it's like cupped.
Yeah, there was like another layer of fabric that's like a hammock.
Yeah, I've got a couple. I've got a couple.
So you
got to
be careful
ones.
Wearing them, motherfuckers, because if you wear those in a pair of like gray
sweatpants, you can't wear dick.
You ain't going home anytime soon.
Yeah.
Do y'all pay attention?
Just don't wear
to
any
underwear.
It's great. Yeah.
Do y'all pay attention to your underwear?
Yeah, you should.
Yeah, I have to.
Like, I mean,
it's very important.
Well, I don't. So I wash them.
I'm shocked.
That's called married life.
Well, I mean, I don't. I really don't. I.
We know what you get for every Christmas and holiday.
Well, I asked for it. Socks and underwear.
Yeah.
Well, that's you ain't buying the right stuff. If you got to buy it every year, you ain't buying the right stuff.
Well, there's nothing worse than waking up, go to work, you put your socks on, your big toe comes out the other end.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, you
I can't
buy
stand
good
that.
Stuff.
That shit happens to me at least once a week, every year.
Yeah.
My big toe will come out the other end of my sock, and it's fucking horrible.
I had some of those cheap Through the Loom boxer briefs one time.
Yeah.
And so you know you got the slit in the front where it's like overlapped. The fabric's overlapped, right? But in these Fruit of the Looms it was like barely overlapped. Shit would just come out.
My ex-husband used to have that problem.
He'd be
like laying on the couch and the dick would just be hanging
out.
I wish
we were having this conversation tomorrow with Dustin Hare in here.
Oh, I can't wait to see
Dustin. Because he's got us all beat. You know what he wears? And like I've already talked about I've already talked to him about this on the show. Dustin wears bikini cut underwear.
Okay.
And the first time that you see him wearing them, you question it. Like, you're like, what the fuck do you have on? And then he tells his story about how he was hunting this one time and he didn't pack any underwear. So he had to go to the dollar store and he bought bikini cut on accident. And comes back and puts them on. Ever since then, he's been in fucking love with them.
Hey, I almost did. It's an addicting kind of thing.
So I'll buy underwear two sizes too big to go hunting in.
What?
I buy the biggest, longest underwear I can get.
Why?
Yeah, go.
You said two sizes.
Would you rather cut your shirt sleeve off?
Yeah.
Or would you rather cut some of your underwear off the wall?
I'd rather just bring toilet paper with me.
Oh.
Yeah,
you said two go hunting with.
Yeah.
Okay, I got it. Or you could just take shit paper.
You could, but yeah, I don't think that far ahead. I'm a man.
You don't keep a roll of shit paper with you at all times?
No. Time out. Y'all don't plot y'all schedule out around shitting? Like, shouldn't you shit before you go?
I shit before I go
everywhere.
Okay,
some of us can't handle when we're going to shit. We just
never
know.
I'm
it's just
going
to happen.
I cannot tell you the last time I shit in public. I don't think in years I have
shit
in public.
Oh, my God.
Public.
Hey man, I shit in the middle of this floor right now. It don't bother me.
I do. I shit. I will.
I would pay money to see that.
Take my time before I go out somewhere because I'm dropping heat before.
So here's
go
the
out.
Deal, though, and I don't know how weird we're getting today, but I will shit with the door open. I don't care. I don't because it's gross to me. But listen, there is a very like personal thing about wiping. I don't know what it is.
You're awkward.
Don't make eye contact
wipe in front of people.
Don't make eye contact.
I got you beat. So like I was locked up earlier when I was younger, right? I used to wait, and I've made it to where my shit schedule was after everyone else went to sleep in the dorms or whatever. I would wait till like 2-3 o'clock in the morning just so I had the bathroom to myself because I don't take quiet shits. I need my space, and I need to just sit there and just think about what I'm doing.
Like so you're in timeout.
Yeah,
that's the one thing I'm not willing to share. I'm sorry. I've been married for how many years, you say? I'm terrible. It's 20.
You're at least 7. You're at least 7.
Eight years.
7 or 8, yeah.
So that's me. That door shut, door's locked. Don't fuck with me. I'm sorry.
Oh, no. I see. If I'm dating somebody and I've been dating for a long time, I want you to talk to me about shit.
Nope.
I would totally talk to you about shit. Like, shitting doesn't bother me.
It does make that.
But it takes up so much time.
But if you were like a person that I knew and you were like, man, I really don't want, but I'm going to totally come in and shit while you're in the bathroom.
Hey, man, you don't know friends.
So I'll lock the door
until you
shower,
shit
then.
Next
I
mean, to each other.
I don't know. I feel like that's a personal thing.
I will not. No. Around my friends, I don't trust my friends enough to shit around my friends. Mm-hmm. I got too many traumatic moments when I was a child of us fucking with each other. Yeah.
Fuck with you.
I don't trust. I don't. No. Absolutely.
Well, I had to endure working on the road for multiple years in an 8-man camp car at 40 foot long. 8 men shared 2 toilets and 2 showers.
Yeah.
So there was no privacy. And now that I have my own house, I'm a big boy now. If I want to go, if I've got the shit, it's me. Just me by myself. Don't fuck with me. If you want to stand on the other side of the door and talk, that's fine. Ain't nobody going to be in there with me. I've done that shit for too long.
Of all people, I'm just surprised that.
Nope. I feel like there is just some parts of, there's just some things that a man does or a woman that they should be entitled to have by themselves. And to me, shitting is one of them.
Yeah. Well, I get it.
I don't know how we got on the topic, but listen, I've shit in a lot of places. The weirdest place to shit is a porta potty.
I will not use a fucking porta potty.
A porta potty because in like the Middle East. Or wherever you are,
have a choice.
Because they don't have plumbing, they don't have toilets, they don't understand how to sit down on something and shit. They have to literally squat. So what they'll do is they'll go in these porta potties, and they will stand on top of the toilet, squat down, and shit everywhere.
Ew, yeah.
And you go in there one time, and you go, you know what? I don't have to do anything. I'm just gonna leave. You don't have to shit anymore.
I'll just go outside.
A whole other reason why we just ought to bomb the whole goddamn area.
Plus a lithium mine.
Goddamn shitting camel jockeys.
It's a lithium mine now. There's really nothing to
shit.
We're going straight to hell. All right, this one's done.
you said it that time.
Check.
Fuck it. I've made you jokes on here before. It'd be okay.
You know, we didn't really talk about the whole selfish thing very long. It was very selfish of us
to
get off
subject. It was very selfish.
Fuck them. You know
what nobody bit. Nobody bit on us. I was like, fuck it. We'll just talk about shit.
The only thing I'll say, man, is keep your circle small. There's a difference between good time and buddies and real buddies.
Yep.
Well, and you've seen my circle. Yeah. You know how small my
yours
circle is.
Small.
I do not invite nobody over to my house that I will not trust to live in my house.
Yeah. Right.
And that's
ooh,
why
I
hate
like
that many people that come
I like
to my house.
That, dude.
Just, if I don't invite you to my house, you shouldn't take it personal. It doesn't mean I think you're a bad person. I don't have room for more people.
Well, you're actually, and I know I haven't been over there as much as I needed to be or as much as you invited me. You're one of the few people's house I actually go to. I'll go to yours. I'll go to Eddie's, Chris's, Trent's. I'll go to his. That's about it. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to a lot of people's houses. I'm weird about that. I'll go to yours too, but you never invited me. But I'm weird about that.
I talk to the same 3 or 4 people every week.
Yeah.
That's it. That is it.
I wish that.
People talk about like circles.
I don't even talk to very many
friends.
People at all. Yeah. Ever.
I mean, I've got 3 or 4 buddies that I'll talk to on a weekly basis. That is it. There's a bunch of friends I got. I got a bunch of friends.
I don't call them friends no more. I call them acquaintances now.
Yep. Well, I don't know. I think that you talk about circles of friends, is it's like a target. You know how there's like rings, and each ring is a different value, right? Yeah. So your tight group that you, your friends that you trust right there in the bullseye, right? It's small. It's like two or three people, right? Yep. And then each run that you go out is different levels of acquaintance and friends to me.
I think I made the mistake being younger, thinking my drinking buddies were my close friends. Like people that I just would get together with and get fucked up with. I think I made the mistake for a long time, and I'm not even going to blame it on them. I think that I put too much into our relationship. Like, I thought more of our relationship than them, and I got mad when they wouldn't put in the same effort. So, like, if I called Neil would be there for me. You'd be there for me. Gypsy would. Got several other friends that would. But I would call, like, a drinking buddy and be like, hey, I need some help. And they'd just be like, I can't. Huh. And be like, oh, okay. So this is my fault now because I thought we were homies.
I would just want to do that experience.
Yeah. Man, I
thought
you
were going to be honest with me. Oh, look at that. You weren't.
Yeah, exactly.
I got family that aren't even in the friend circle.
I don't have family.
They're the worst.
Yeah. I got one cousin, Justin, that I would consider him. The rest of mine, fuck.
I try not to hang out with people that. Let me say this so it don't make me sound like a mooch. I try not to hang out with people that I will not better from being around.
Yes.
Not monetarily. Just I don't want to hang out with somebody that's gonna make me have bad habits.
You're right. Supposed to be the least successful person in the room.
Yeah. I try to be around people that give me good ideas or give me good.
I want to hang out with people that inspire me too.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. It doesn't matter how much money you have.
Right. I don't give a shit about that.
If you're living your life and I like the way you're doing your shit. If mm-hmm. if I'm learning good habits from you, then I want to be around you. People in high school, it just so happens in high school, your high school buddies, 9 times out of 10. It ain't gonna be like that. You grow apart. Everybody. Yeah. Well, you said something that I it's been in the back of my head ever since you said it about the being married thing.
Yeah.
You know, get people that get married young.
Yeah.
You know, you get married young. Yeah. You think you got it going on, and then the older you get, the more you're.
Well, you don't know who you are yet.
Right.
And that's my thing where I never wanted to get married young. And it, yeah, exactly.
Those are the marriages that are just doomed.
Yeah. If you get married young, how do you make a commitment to someone for the rest of your life when you don't even know who you are yet?
Yeah.
I didn't know who I wanted to be till I was damn near 30.
Yep.
If I would have married somebody at 20, they would have been marrying a piece of shit, somebody who had nothing going for them. And, like, I would have been locked into that life. I would have never got to grow. I would have never got to become the person I am today. I would have missed out a lot of opportunities because of that marriage. And it's not just you. The person that you're marrying, they're missing out on a lot, too. It's both. Because where we're from, you're taught, hey, you just got out of high school. Get fucking married once you get a job and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah, because how many people can honestly say their priorities were the same at 20 as they are at 30?
Mine aren't the same as it was 3 fucking years ago.
I mean, everybody's priorities change.
Hell no.
Yeah. And like, I don't knock people that get married. If you get married and you're happy, fuck yeah, be happy. Right. Like, I'm not telling you, but I think that's why divorce is so fucking high. Is you make that commitment, you've been divorced 3 times.
3 times.
Yeah. It's just pressure.
Yeah,
it is.
It's just an outside pressure to fit into the peg. Like you have to fit into the shape that you. That's what you're supposed to be as an American. You're supposed to get out of school, go to college, get married.
That's another problem that I have with a lot of folks too, is when people start talking about like fitting in, I don't think anybody's supposed to fit into anything. I think you're supposed to make your own fucking box. I'm supposed to make my own fucking hole.
And that box
can
change anytime.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I said, I have a lot of different personalities. I don't even know who I am on a certain day. Yeah. So fuck, how am I supposed to know who you need me to be?
There's times I wake up and I fucking hate me. There's times I wake up.
We all wake up some days like that.
And it's just like, how right now would I expect someone to understand everything about me? Or like, but
when
also,
you can't even explain it to yourself.
I don't have to, but that's the good part. Yeah. I don't have to explain it to anybody.
Right.
And I think that's where like a lot of people get tripped up or whatever. If you spend half your life explaining why you are, who you are, and the mood you're in to folks, you kind of forget to live.
Yeah. I'll tell you one thing, that's they say it's addicting, but it's really habits, is living alone. When you live alone, man.
Oh, dude, I'm right now.
You realize some shit about yourself that you did not know. And then you realize that you don't want to be around certain things anymore.
Mm-hmm. Oh, boy.
But if you're married or you're in a relationship, you live with somebody, there's no way out of it.
Nope.
And you want to know why depression is so crazy or suicide rate is so high. It's because people are having to be what they don't want to be all the time.
All the time.
Like, you literally can't turn it off. If you turn it off and you fire somebody's emoji, you put a fire emoji on somebody's thing. That's what happens, man. You're like, fuck, I thought I liked that. Well, you're not allowed to. Oh, fuck.
When people realize it's actually okay. You know why I like the fucking alphabet community? Is I like the fucking ones who realize that it's okay to be yourself.
Yes.
I can respect that. Because
your G's.
Yeah. I think that everybody is just supposed to find themselves and be happy with and content with being who you are. If you want to work a fucking 9-to-5 and that makes you happy,
yeah,
fucking, I love you for that. If you want to fucking reach for the stars and don't give a fuck if you go broke doing it and you fail and make yourself like an asshole, I'm fine with that. I'm fine with both ends of the spectrum on it, as long as you are happy with who you are every day. 1,000%. And I think there's so many people that fucking hide that.
It took me all the way to the point in my life. Like, it took my whole life to figure that out.
Yeah.
You had to fuck a lot of stuff up to figure that out.
You have to screw up a lot.
You know, and I've said it 1,000 times on the show, but it's literally something stupid that I live by. You're going to know it, so I'm not going to ask you. Gypsy, do you know why 409, the spray bottle, is called 409?
No.
Do y'all know? Tell them, Cam.
It's literally the 409th experiment.
They got it wrong 408 times.
Oh, really?
That's why it's called 409.
Well, Jesus Christ, I'm ready for my break. I'm on 408.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So, like, you're supposed to fail. Anything in life. Did you ever learn anything in life from actually getting it right?
No, I've always tried like 4 or 5 times before I fucking up.
I've always learned from getting shit wrong how to make the next step or the next time I do it better.
Watching my stupid friends fuck it up, that definitely helped me.
See, I'm not that smart. I have to fuck up on my own.
It took me a long time to figure that one out.
I have to fuck a lot of stuff up on my own
before I realized, oh, I just watch them. Oh, yep, don't do that.
Yeah. I've learned a lot that way, too. I've had a lot of friends fuck
it
up.
It takes a lot of maturity to reach that.
I know what not to do.
I always get surprised. I'm not going to say his name. I got a friend.
Jack.
Yeah, Jack. We'll call him Jack. I got a friend that I just have adored since childhood that I love that'll never grow the fuck up.
Yeah.
That he's stuck and he's happy with nothing.
I'm talking about cutting people off. I had to literally remove a person like that.
Well, he's not happy. He just doesn't know a better way of life.
Oh, okay.
Now, he dude's got to be miserable. I mean, there's no way this cat isn't fucking miserable. And I have got more gas in my tank from watching him and realizing I don't want to be this way.
Yeah.
I haven't learned a lot from my friends that have failed, but it showed me what I don't want. It showed me, like, I'm not living that fucking life. I will go above and beyond. Or seeing, like, people that are miserable.
I think that's why I've been married and divorced so many times, because I've seen my parents. They've been married 50 years.
Yeah.
Fucking miserable.
Oh, my mom and dad.
Fucking miserable people.
My mom and dad, like, finally this week got a divorce. Like, the paper signed, fucking finally.
Congrats.
They would have been so goddamn happy.
Yeah.
So fucking happy 30 fucking years ago.
Yeah.
If they had just went on separate ways.
And who else would
have
been happy?
Quit in them.
Huh?
Who else would have been happy? Had they been happy?
Yeah. The kids would have been happy.
Because of that stupid ass pressure we're talking about.
Yeah.
It's because you're supposed to. Because only.
Well, they use the excuse for the longest time.
Kids come from a marriage.
My parents used the excuse for the longest time. Well, we've got too much in each other's name together. We've got land together.
Guess what? It takes about a month to get
it figured out. Start over. I had a woman on this show, and I cannot fucking remember who it was, but it was a while ago.
Jane.
It might have been back when I first started. But she told me she was so fucking scared to get divorced. But she got to the point to where she's like, I'd rather be fucking broke. I'd rather live in a fucking cardboard box. I'd rather than live another fucking day like this. And she said that after she got divorced, she left her husband. She was broke as fuck for a long time. It was the happiest she had ever been.
Think back to your happiest times.
Okay, mine would definitely be after an abusive relationship, my last marriage.
I was dead broke.
Yeah, exactly.
I was dead broke. I had nothing.
More money, more problems. I don't care what they fucking
say.
Dead
broke. I'm gonna talk about noodles.
I mean, I like having some of them fucking problems, but it's the truth.
I'll tear up some ramen noodles in a heartbeat.
I done fucked up.
But the happiest time was when I realized I got out of that.
Yeah.
That I was like, I'm sitting here with nothing.
Yeah.
But in my car, that's all I have.
It's peace. That's what you're giving up a lot. You might be giving up monetary stuff and all this other stuff, but you're gaining peace. It's just stuff.
No price on that one.
Yeah, you can't fucking put. Hey, look, when those arguments stop, or better yet, like somebody's been in like my position with some people. Neil knows more about it than anybody. But like not arguing with somebody.
It's freeing.
Not having to bitch. There's a price that you'll have to pay for shit, but not arguing with somebody every fucking moment of your life.
Adds years to your life.
Or just sitting in the house and they walk in and you go, okay, what mood am I going to be in today?
Right. Do I have to walk on eggshells today? Or
yeah, I'll tell you this, and I hadn't had to live it very long. I could not be in a marriage or living with somebody and it was cold every day you walked in.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's icy from that person.
Yeah.
Like, and it's not even just them sometimes. Sometimes it's you being that way towards them. I wouldn't want to fucking do that. Hit me with a truck.
Yep.
That shit, me having to do it for the time that I had to was rough.
But I will say, normal marriages, it's not all rainbows and stuff.
Oh, absolutely. I would imagine it would be.
You're never always going to agree.
Yeah.
Ever. You're never going to always agree. You're going to get older. Your priorities are going to change. And you're going to see the world in different ways, the way things should be. Well, what matters is whether or not you can work through it and grow old and figure out a way to meet in the middle. Because you're never going to meet somebody that agrees with everything you say.
It'd be boring if you did. Well, let me ask you, because you're still married, and everybody in here, you're married, or you have been, Gypsy. Let me ask y'all, where's the line? Because I've never been married. Where is the line? We'll call it the happiness line, I guess. And how you were just saying, like, you're not going to agree with somebody. I wouldn't imagine you would. You can't.
My line.
Where is the line?
My line would come to the betterment of my child. If my marriage started to bring my child down, and it's making him, it's being hard on him. That me and his mother are together, and it's affecting him. That's where I draw the line.
I would agree. That's a great line. I would agree with him on that one.
I put my happiness at the bottom,
yeah,
below my child. My child is the most important thing in the world. I'll swallow 10 tons of shit if it means that it makes him happy.
Yeah.
And that's what I kill a motherfucker over my kid. I don't know how else to put it.
No, I get it. Trust me.
My happiness, I swallow a lot of things. There's some things that bother me, some things that goes great, whatever. At the end of the day, if my child's happy, healthy, and everything's going good with him, then that's the most important part to me. That's not to say that should be the most important part to everybody, but that's my line.
That's a pretty good fucking line, though, for everybody.
Yeah.
I wasn't expecting that answer from you. That's a very mature, very good answer.
Well, he didn't ask to be here.
Yeah.
Two consenting adults brought him here. It's our responsibility to give him the best life, better than what we had.
Yeah.
And that means swallowing shit, right? That means it's our responsibility to give him a better life and give him the life he deserves, because he didn't ask to fucking be here.
You're a wise man.
He's a good dude. I told you. Neil's one of those, I'm telling you.
Shit sneaks up on you.
I don't get to see him as much as I fucking like to. Mm-hmm. He's one of those. He's a real motherfucker.
Yeah. 10 points to Gryffindor.
Yeah.
Not sure.
All right. We're getting out of here. This was the fourth that.
Yeah.
He's like,
Star Wars.
What the fuck did you call me?
Yeah. It's one of the houses in Star Trek.
It's fucking Harry Potter.
Yeah, I don't know about that.
Yeah, I know you didn't. That's why I
do it. Dude, I kept smoking the Bandit on reruns.
You look like it.
I used to be the Bandit fan until I got older, and now I watch it for Buford T.
It's true.
When I was younger, I used to love the Bandit, but now I watch it for Buford.
I want a Diablo sandwich and Dr. Pepper in a goddamn hurry.
It's funny how the older we get, our characters that we used to like, you're like, I don't like that motherfucker. I like the other one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I like the bad guy. Yeah,
when he told his son he wished his goddamn head was in the hat, I get it. I feel it now.
When I get home, I'm going to punch your mama right in the mouth. There is no way, no way you came from my loins. All right.
Fourth day of Christmas over with out of the 12 days coming up. I want to get y'all two back when we do like the actual Christmas special. If y'all can come in, we're going to have a lot of folks. Matthew, just a lot of folks. It's going to be kind of weird how I do it this year, but just anybody that's been part of the show this year, this family now. Gypsy, I'm going to try to record it while you're still here, actually, and just air it later. Okay. So, I just appreciate y'all coming and being part of the show and fucking hanging out with me for a little bit. And throughout the rest of your – Neil, you've been on a couple episodes this year, and before you've been on a lot. Cam, you've been on a couple now. Gypsy, you've been on a fucking lot, it seems like, lately. So, just appreciate y'all taking time.
Well, thanks for having me.
By the way, thank you once again to I got to say them again because I feel fucking wonderful.
Actually do, too.
Besides, I can't quit pissing. I'm telling you, like, everything
feels
full.
Did that B12 shot, like, make your pee red?
No, but it made it stink.
That's
gallstones. That might be the chlamydia.
Kidney stones.
I don't have chlamydia.
No, I didn't say you. I said me.
Oh, yeah. Definitely you probably too.
Definitely. Definitely getting it before the end of the year. Anyway, all right. Thank you again to Alive and Well Hydration. They'll be on the show tomorrow to explain to you why you need what me and Gypsy received today. Thank y'all to Jason and Justin. We'll see y'all tomorrow. And thank y'all for listening to the Josh Terry Podcast. We'll catch you next time.
At the Home Depot, we have the tools for you to give the gift of a smarter home with savings on top brands. Like the Google Hub, a command center for your smart devices that raises the IQ of your entire home. Or the Nest Learning Thermostat that helps you conserve energy and save on your bill. And if you don't know what to get, gift cards are a smart gift no matter what they get. So this year, gift smarter with savings on tools to make your holiday magic. The Home Depot, how doers get more done.
This view was worth a hike.
Right? And it's a good way to stay on top of my health.
Yes, I'm Cologuard, a prescription colon cancer screening option for people 45 plus at average risk. Have you screened for colon cancer?
Not yet.
Don't wait. It's more treatable when caught in early stages.
Tell me more.
Cologuard is non-invasive and it's used at home. It detects altered DNA in your stool to find 92% of colon cancers.
92%?
Yep, even those in early stages.
This was seen in a clinical study with patients 50 and older. Any positive result should be followed by a diagnostic colonoscopy. False positive and negative results may occur. Cologuard is not a replacement for colonoscopy in high-risk patients. Do not use if you have had adenomas, have inflammatory bowel disease and certain hereditary syndromes, or a personal or family history of colon cancer.
Most insured patients pay $0. Ask your provider or an online prescriber if Cologuard is right for you, or visit Cologuard.com.
I'm in.